Now we're going to spotlight some magnificent WNYC investigative reporting on how doctors who lose their licenses can sometimes continue to practice anyway. The story begins in the early 1990s when one OBGYN in upstate New York was stripped of his license to practice medicine. This after a state investigation found that he was a, quote, imminent danger after a series of grave outcomes for mothers and babies in his care. But this doctor then went on to practice elsewhere and eventually regained his license here in New York. So WNYC's got this investigative podcast series called Imminent Danger, taking the story of this doctor and his patients in order to examine the gaps and the safeguards that are supposed to hold medical professionals accountable and protect patients systemically. So joining me now to discuss their reporting are Christopher Wirth, Senior Investigations and Narrative Editor here at WNYC and Gothamist, and journalist Karen Shakurji, who reported out the series. All five episodes of Imminent Danger, produced in partnership with the Pulitzer Center, are available now wherever you get your podcasts. So, Karen, welcome to WNYC. And, Chris, always good to have you on the show.
Thank you.
Good to be back.
So, Karen, the big question is really about the system more than it is about the individual doctor. But tell us a little bit about his story and how the credentialing worked in this case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the story focuses on this one physician. His name is Thomas J. Byrne. And as you say, we look at his career, but we also focus on his career as a way to understand the systems at play. So he's an OBGYN who's also a maternal fetal medicine specialist, which means that he's trained to focus on more high risk or complicated cases. He currently has active licenses in New York and Texas, and works with a practice in the Bronx that's part of the St. Barnabas Health System, and in Amarillo, Texas, at a practice that's affiliated with Texas Tech Health Sciences, Texas Tech University Health Sciences Center there.
And for your reporting, well, I guess we should tell an individual story just so people know the kind of thing where, that prompted this. You tell in episode one the story of Wei Chi Lam, a recent graduate of Columbia who went by the name Amy. She was originally from Hong Kong, I see, but moved to Harlem with her husband and first child to study journalism. Amy's story takes a tragic turn after she gives birth to their second child at home. So very briefly, how does that relate to this story?
Amy arrived at Harlem Hospital not too long after giving birth at home unexpectedly. The way that her story and what happened to her relates to the podcast is that one of the physicians who took care of her after she arrived at Harlem Hospital was Dr. Byrne. She had a series of procedures that were done on her there. And unfortunately, over the span of several hours, she lost blood, and none of the procedures that were done to try and stop the bleeding helped. She died at Harlem Hospital about 11 or so hours after giving birth at home. And so Dr. Byrne is one of five physicians who were named in a lawsuit filed against him and Harlem Hospital for her death.
And for your reporting, you spoke to Susan Carton, an attorney here in New York who specializes in medical malpractice cases and who represented Amy's family in a lawsuit. There were five other physicians who were involved in Amy's wrongful death lawsuit. But to Susan Carton, Dr. Byrne stood out. So we're going to play about a 45-second clip of what Susan Carton said when she deposed Byrne as a lawyer. We'll hear Susan Carton's voice first, and Karen asks her a follow-up question in this clip.
I started to question with great detail is, what was your background? And it came out that he had lost his license. It had been revoked, which is very serious in New York.
According to public records from New York State's Health Department, Back in the early 90s, the state investigated Dr. Byrne and found him guilty of things like gross negligence, gross incompetence, negligence on more than one occasion, incompetence on more than one occasion, obtaining a license fraudulently, and practicing the profession fraudulently. That last one is a reference to making a false statement in a patient's medical record.
There was notations in his record from New York State that this man was in imminent danger to patients.
And so, Chris, there's the title of your podcast series, Imminent Danger. It comes from a finding about this doctor by the state of New York. What does it actually mean? And I guess the question that the listeners who just heard that exchange will have on their minds is, wait, if they found all those things previously and had revoked the license, mm-hmm. how was he relicensed to practice in the state?
Yeah, so to get to your first question, the state health department labeled him an imminent danger as a means of suspending his license. So this was in 1990. The state had apparently identified, you know, a number of cases.
Suspended, because I don't want to be inaccurate here. Suspended, not revoked.
Yeah, that was what allowed the health commissioner or the health department to suspend his license, keep him from practicing while the state conducted its investigation. And then it was a year later after that investigation concluded that his license was fully revoked.
Okay.
And in terms of what allowed him to keep practicing, you know, at the time, you know, these cases that we're talking about from the 90s happened up near Rochester. And the Democrat and Chronicle, a paper up there, actually followed this case fairly closely. There were several hearings that were held into Byrne's conduct as a physician. And at the end of that process, once that license was revoked, Democrat and Chronicle quotes a spokesperson for the state health department who says, it would be very difficult, not impossible, but very difficult for Dr. Byrne to get his license back in New York. And what we can see in the medical board records that Karen has worked so hard to obtain is that Byrne, within a year of fully losing his license in New York, had obtained a medical license in New Mexico and had gone on to practice there. He did so for several years, and then he went on to Oklahoma, where he also obtained a medical license and practiced for several years in Oklahoma, and then he went back to New Mexico. And then it was about 20 years after that that he ended up back in New York and regaining his license.
So did Oklahoma and New Mexico know what had happened in New York?
Yeah, we can see that, for example, New Mexico, you can hear this in the podcast, New Mexico, there's a letter that was generated by the medical board that did acknowledge the fact that it was aware of what had happened in New York and that Byrne's license had been revoked here.
But
the state decided to grant him a license anyway. He went on to work, we know, in a fairly rural area of New Mexico near the U.S.-Mexico border. And this is something that we get into in a later episode. But what patient safety experts have told us is that, you know, Dr. Byrne is called an MFM. He's a maternal fetal medicine specialist. So not only is he an OBGYN, but he is trained to take care of high-risk cases. There are hospitals and other providers in the country, particularly in rural areas or maybe even also in urban areas that serve low-income communities, that really struggle to recruit those kinds of providers, those kinds of specialists. And so, therefore, even when you look at a medical license application, you might be willing to overlook those certain warning signs or the fact that a doctor has had their license revoked in another state in order to bring those kinds of specialists to the state or to a specific hospital.
And Karen, I see that your research shows OBGYNs are actually the most sued doctors of all the specializations, and lawsuits aren't necessarily an indication of a bad doctor, right? So do you want to put this case into the broader industry context in that way?
Yeah, I think it's important to keep in mind that lawsuits and perhaps the number of lawsuits can tell us something about a physician, but it really, I think, is helpful to think of it as one piece of a bigger picture. As you say, OBGYNs are some of the most sued kinds of doctors. And you know, for physicians who've been practicing for a very long time, that can, you know, potentially mean more malpractice claims have been filed against them. But I did have two studies that were a helpful reference point on this, one from the American Medical Association and another from the American Congress of Obstetricians and Gynecologists. And they had found that all the OBGYNs they surveyed had been sued on average about 1 to 3 times in their careers up until that point. So that's a reference point there.
Right. And Chris, the first two episodes are about this one specific doctor, but the 5-part podcast series really uses this case to look at how doctors are vetted and how their work is monitored. Medical malpractice can be one of various factors. So can you talk about which systems, at least in New York State, are charged with monitoring doctors and how a medical professional lands on their radar?
Yeah, New York is unique in that the education department licenses physicians. The health department investigates those physicians. And what we know is that that process, for example, for investigating a physician is largely complaint driven. So, you know, the health department receives complaints about a physician and then can then initiate some kind of inquiry into that physician. The other thing that we look at in the series is something called the National Practitioner Data Bank, which was created by Congress in the 80s. It started to collect data in the 90s. It's basically a compendium of various information about physicians that's not really – it's not geared towards the user or the patient. It's geared towards hospitals or medical boards. And so what it does is it requires – medical boards or hospitals to report certain kinds of disciplinary actions against physicians. So, for example, the suspension of privileges, hospital privileges, or some kind of disciplinary action that a medical board takes, or even malpractice payments. But what we found is that there are loopholes into that system that actually allow hospitals particularly to circumvent reporting those kinds of incidents. And we have an interesting stat in the series, which is that almost half of hospitals in the country have never reported a single physician to that data bank in the 33 years that it's existed. And I can get into some of the details about those, you know, what kind of loopholes exist. But basically what we found is that it does allow for hospitals to circumvent those kinds of.
Is this underreporting that you're citing, perhaps because hospitals don't want to look like they have doctors who are committing malpractice?
That's what, you know, the various people who Karen specifically spoke to did say that, you know, hospitals are, you know, they have an incentive not to report because once it becomes clear that maybe they have a problematic physician, it becomes, you know, there are reputational risks involved in that.
Yeah. And I see you also reported that there's a financial aspect there. Typically a hospital, when there's a malpractice case against a doctor practicing in a hospital, it's the hospital that makes those payments on a doctor's behalf.
Yeah. You know, in the podcast, we call this the corporate shield. That's what it's known as, is that, you know, a lot of times what will happen is that when a patient does sue a physician, they'll also sue the hospital. We're told that, you know, sometimes attorneys often or sometimes at least encourage a patient to sue the hospital. It's a faster route towards a settlement. And even in cases where a physician is named, once it gets to the settlement process, the physician can be removed. And in fact, in Amy Lamb's case, the patient who at Harlem Hospital, who you talked about at the beginning of this segment, that's what happened when her husband sued Byrne in Harlem Hospital, is that it was health and hospitals that ultimately settled that case.
And one other loophole, if loophole is the right word, Karen, you key in on doctor resignations. Basically, if a doctor resigns, then there isn't really a need for a paper trail. Do I have that right?
It depends on the circumstances. If they are resigning specifically to avoid an investigation, that is supposed to be reportable to the National Practitioner Data Bank. So it depends a little bit on the details. But yes, often doctors will be tipped off, and that an investigation may be going in, you know, starting on them, and they will be given the opportunity to resign instead of having their clinical privileges restricted or taken away.
Katherine Massey, Book Club, The Context of White Supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy for non-white people, victims of racism. Today's date, Thursday, November 16th, 2023. So I have been told. This is our fifth study session on James B. Stewart's Blind Eye. I had a totally different audio segment to start off this week's portion of the reading. Was excited about it too. We just had Robert Kaplan as a guest on the program from Australia. He said, check out Charles Cullen. I did so. I had a whole 60-minute segment. You know I love 60 minutes. They talked to Charles Cullen. It was right bang lined up what we're talking about. But then I checked New York Public Radio. The segment we started with is from this month. Karen Shakeridge, Christopher Worth, they were speaking with Brian Lair about all of their research. Mostly they're focused on this one, Dr. Thomas J. Byrne, B-Y-R-N-E. They mentioned Wei Chi Lam, non-white female, died in childbirth. They talked about maternal mortality rates in the U.S. They didn't include this as a part of it. When I looked for this so-called Dr. Byrne, they have other investigative reports about people that died. They showed another victim of white supremacy racism who is also a non-white female. How in the world do you end up with all the, oh, they said, when you're desperate and you need doctors and you got this credentialed, I suspect, white man, all these years of experience, oh my God, yeah, we'll take him, come in right now. Didn't we already hear that in this book? And didn't we hear that specifically about Zimbabwe, because they said, hey, with Dr. Byrne, go to the border of Mexico. Oh my gosh, you got lots of dark people there. They can't even speak English and just climbed over the border. Oh my God, we don't have that wall. Go down there. You can be a doctor and kill all the people that you want to. Just like going to Zimbabwe. Anyway, the other reason that I played that segment, they mentioned the National Practitioner Database. That's going to be mentioned today specifically. Last thing I get in, man, they said white people don't get fired. They get transferred. They don't just get transferred. They get tipped off. How do you come under investigation for malpractice? You done stole the fentanyl and everything else. And hey. Swangy, look here. Think they coming to check on you, man. Ixnay, out of here. You don't even get tipped off if you steal chicken nuggets from McDonald's. Katherine Massey, Book Club, picking up in Chapter 6. Remember, he was convicted last week. 5 years, not even going to serve all of that. Audio segment 1.
After sitting through Swango's trial, Ed Morgan, the Franklin County prosecutor, told the Plain Dealer, "The verdicts indicated to me that we are now investigating a man who was obviously a very sick individual and has to be considered a very dangerous individual. It indicates to me and my office that we are on the right track in pressing the investigation, and we will continue the investigation. Morgan realized nonetheless that Swango was a formidable adversary. The doctor had been a poised and seemingly earnest witness. In Morgan's opinion, smooth and good-looking. He could see why women fell for him. Had Swango opted for a trial by jury, the prosecutor wasn't sure he would have been convicted. But the courtroom testimony, especially the evidence of Swango's fixation on death and disaster, convinced Morgan that he might very well be dealing with a psychopath. He returned to Ohio convinced that Swango had committed crimes at Ohio State, probably murder. In June, Morgan hired an experienced homicide detective, Patrick McSweeney, to investigate Swango full-time on behalf of the prosecuting attorney's office. Morgan and McSweeney set up an office at the Ohio State Police headquarters, where they joined efforts with Ely, the medical board investigator, and Hurt, who remained in charge of the overall investigation. They frequently consulted the Franklin County coroner, William Adrian, and an Ohio State University toxicologist, Daniel Corey. To minimize the earlier frictions between the police and hospital personnel, all interviews with doctors, nurses, and other hospital employees were coordinated through Michael Covert, who had replaced Donald Boyanowski as the hospital's executive director. Finally, interviews with eyewitnesses got underway in earnest, though not without continuing problems at the hospital. Arranging interviews through Covert was time-consuming. Robert Holder, as Chief Hurd had predicted, had taken a new job as special assistant to Zagornis. Out of concern for patient confidentiality, Holder insisted on a subpoena before providing any documents, which was also a cumbersome and time-consuming process. Some relatives of possible Swango victims, such as the parents of the young gymnast Cynthia Ann McGee, had quietly accepted monetary settlements from Ohio State. The investigators were angered to learn that as a condition of the settlements, Ohio State had required the families to remain silent, even to the police, unless they obtained a subpoena. As McSweeney later described the process, "Everyone on the OSU staff was hesitant. Appointments were broken. We made it as convenient as possible. We'd go at 2 a.m. if that's what they wanted. Not one of them showed up on time. Once we waited 3 hours for a doctor to show up. They sent some doctors away, out of town, when we wanted them. I got the impression that they thought we were just dumb cops, and they were the saviors of mankind. I've dealt with hospitals for years on homicides, and I've never seen anything to compare to the treatment we got at OSU. Still, McSweeney, Harp, and the others were able to interview and in many cases videotape the statements of such crucial witnesses as Raina Cooper, her roommate, Iwonia Utz, the head resident on duty that night, Reese Freeman, and numerous other doctors and nurses. After scouring the record of every patient who had died in the hospital during Swango's rotations, they were able to identify 5 suspicious deaths, plus the possible poisonings of the doctors at Children's Hospital, and interview the doctors and nurses involved. The results were startlingly at odds with the conclusions of the hospital's own investigation. McGee, the gymnast, had not died of a pulmonary embolism, as Goodman reported, apparently relying on a hearsay account of the autopsy results. On January 14th, the head resident had asked Swango to draw a blood sample from McGee. At about 11:15 p.m., Swango told a nurse he was going to draw the sample. He was seen heading toward her room carrying a syringe and culture bottles. At about midnight, a nurse found that McGee had a pale, dusty, bluish look and called a code, to which Swango didn't respond. The code was unsuccessful, and McGee was pronounced dead. Another doctor reported that 6 days later, Swango had been among a group of doctors making evening rounds on the neurosurgery floor, but had been alone with patient Ricky DeLong while the others examined DeLong's roommate. Swango had called out to them, "I think your patient is dead," which had come as a shock since DeLong had seemed to be in stable condition. Swango had later written on the patient's progress notes that he was pronounced dead at 18:03 hours, family notified, Franklin County Coroner's Office notified of death. They will assume jurisdiction and perform autopsy. Swango called DeLong's wife and told her DeLong had died of a heart attack. When she became distraught, he repeated the information to her mother. Family members came to the hospital, met with Swango, and requested an autopsy. They completed an autopsy form given them by Swango, but the form was never filed, and no autopsy was performed. Similarly, in the highly suspicious death of Ryan Walter, who started gasping and lost consciousness 10 minutes after a visit from Swango, Swango signed the death certificate, citing the cause as cardiopulmonary arrest. There was no autopsy. And in the case of Ruth Barrick, whose death had so upset Nurse Ann Ritchie, Swango filled out a form on which he stated that this is not a coroner's case, and the coroner will not assume jurisdiction. Again, he had ensured that no autopsy would be performed. Far from being routine, as Goodman and Whitcomb had indicated in their respective reports, the other deaths had seemed mysterious to the hospital's medical staff at the time they occurred. When the investigators interviewed Dr. Mark Cooperman about the death of Charlotte Warner, he told them, "The first problem that I had with her case, that I didn't understand, was the results of the autopsy, and that demonstrated what they called multicentric thrombosis. Basically, what happened is she had developed clots in all of her major arteries. She had clots in the arteries in her heart, in the vessels to the intestine, in the vessels to her kidneys, to her liver, and to her lungs. And I could never understand why this type of thing would have happened to somebody who had undergone a straightforward surgical procedure 5 days earlier and was walking around having no problems. And so it always bothered me." In early 1985, when Cooperman learned that castor beans had been found in Swango's apartment in Quincy, he consulted some toxicology texts at the medical school library. When he discovered that ricin poisoning causes, in his words, blood clots, thrombosis, and thromboembolism throughout the vascular system, and thus might explain Warner's baffling autopsy findings, Cooperman called his attorney, and they decided to notify the coroner. Cooperman thus became the first and only doctor at Ohio State to initiate contact with an investigative authority outside the hospital. When asked about Evelyn Perenni, the gallbladder patient who also experienced bizarre bleeding, even from her eyes, Dr. Gary Birkin told the investigators that such bleeding typically occurs in poisonings. He said that Swango had examined Perenni before she experienced the bleeding and total body failure. In the now notorious case of Raina Cooper, there was none of the ambiguity or conflicting testimony that had caused Dr. Whitcomb to dismiss the whole affair as a grand mal seizure. Carolyn Beery, the student nurse whose testimony had been belittled as unreliable, was even now, a year after the incident, quite certain that she had seen Dr. Swango from a distance of only 3 feet standing by Cooper's bed. "It looked like he was putting something in her IV," she now told the OSU police. "I knew he was putting something in. You can just tell." John Sigg, the first nurse to respond to Beery's calls for help that night, testified that Beery told him when he arrived that she'd seen Dr. Swango with a syringe doing something to Cooper's IV. He recalled that Cooper, too, told him, "The doctor put something in my IV." But the most telling interviews were of Cooper and her roommate, whose earlier accounts had been dismissed as unreliable, if not delusional. Utz, the roommate, said she was alert and perfectly capable of remembering what she had seen. She remembered quite clearly that a doctor came into the room, and he gave her a shot or something, and I just started screaming for the nurse. I started screaming like mad. Utz described the doctor as young, with blonde hair and glasses, wearing a white coat. Moreover, she said she recognized Swango as the doctor when she saw pictures of him on television after his arrest in Illinois. Cooper said she was wide awake that evening and not suffering any after effects from her anesthetic. She remembered that a blonde-haired person had come into her room and, using a syringe, had injected something into her IV. She was lying on her side, so she couldn't see the person's face, but she thought it was a man. She said nothing about the yellow pharmacy jacket that had figured so prominently in the doctor's earlier exoneration of Swango and seemed puzzled by questions about it. She testified that as a blackness spread through her body and she realized she could not speak, she deliberately rattled the bed rail in order to attract attention. That is, she was deliberately shaking the bed rail. She wasn't suffering a seizure. She recalled writing the notes because she couldn't speak with the tube in her mouth and throat. Morgan went to some lengths to determine the basis for the hospital's conclusion that Cooper had been paranoid and thus potentially delusional. It appeared that another doctor had reported that Cooper had accused the OSU neurologist, Dr. George Paulson, of trying to burglarize her home. And this was the basis for the conclusion that she was suffering paranoid ideation. But in her interview with OSU police, Cooper vehemently denied ever accusing any doctor of such a thing. While her house had been burglarized, she hadn't suspected Dr. Paulson, who in any event wouldn't have known where she lived. Dr. Paulson, too, said that to his knowledge, Cooper had never made any such allegation, and said he wasn't the source for the report. Thus, the diagnosis of Cooper's mental state appeared to rest on the flimsiest of hearsay, and, as far as Morgan was concerned, was completely unjustified. The investigators also interviewed the three doctors who had spoken to Swango about the incident: Freeman, the head resident, Carey, the chief of surgery, and Whitcomb, who headed the hospital inquiry. Freeman, the first to speak to Swango, testified that, "I confronted him, Swango, and did question him, and he said he was not in the room. Nor did he see her, Cooper, just prior to the incident." Dr. Carey reported that, "I asked him whether, in fact, he had done anything to Mrs. Cooper or injected anything in her IV, and he said no. I explained to him that there had been an incident report suggesting that he had, and he said no. He was in the room at the request of one of the two patients, and I don't remember which one, to get her slippers for her. And he had gotten the patient's slippers. Whether it was Mrs. Cooper or the other person in the room, I don't remember. But that's all he had done. And he hadn't done anything with the intravenous line." Dr. Whitcomb made this statement to the OSU police when he was interviewed on February 15, 1985. "He, Swango, told me he was in the room, as I remember now, that he was in there to draw blood. That was the reason for him to have been in the room, and that he either had a brief conversation with Mrs. Cooper, or some contact with her, and left the room, and the next thing he remembers was to recognize that there was a resuscitation effort going on in that room." This statement differs from the account Whitcomb earlier gave Meeks. Thus, the testimony indicated that Swango had given three inconsistent accounts: that he wasn't in the room, that he went in to get slippers, that he went in to draw blood. As for the diagnosis of Cooper's respiratory arrest as a grand mal seizure, Dr. Brakel, who witnessed it with Dr. Freeman and helped resuscitate Cooper, said the symptoms didn't indicate such a seizure, but were instead consistent with a paralyzing drug, specifically the anesthetic anectine, to which Swango would have had ready access while he was in the hospital. Armed with the witnesses' accounts, Morgan, Hurt, and the other investigators turned to the physical evidence. To their dismay, none of the syringes used by Swango had been saved, nor had any of the patient's IV tubes. And, of course, Nurse Moore had thrown away the syringe discovered by Risley after no one showed any interest in it, and she was told Swango had been cleared. Through the coroner's office, the investigators did have tissue and fluid samples from all the patients on whom autopsies had been performed. The bodies of the three patients who were not autopsied, DeLong, Walter, and Barrick, were exhumed. But just as Morgan and prosecuting attorney Miller had feared, detecting the presence of poisons or paralyzing drugs proved a daunting and frustrating task. Given the supplies found in Swango's apartment in Quincy, they tested for arsenic and nicotine, and also tried to come up with a test for ricin. Because it was readily available in the hospital and could have caused Cooper's symptoms, they also tested for anectine. None of the samples tested positive for arsenic, which was not surprising, since the only victims who showed any symptoms of arsenic poisoning, the doctors at Children's Hospital, had vomited heavily, and also had apparently been poisoned on only one occasion. Two patients, Warner and Perenni, showed symptoms consistent with ricin poisoning. But there was no test for ricin, although the OSU toxicologists worked for months to find one. None of the samples tested revealed any residue of anectine, which was suspected in the Cooper incident and in the deaths that didn't involve massive bleeding. but a nectine passes quickly out of the body, often leaving no trace. However, Coroner Adrian did make a startling discovery when he performed an autopsy on the corpse of Ricky DeLong. Gauze had been stuffed into his trachea, causing suffocation. Adrian changed DeLong's official cause of death to cardiopulmonary arrest due to gauze and trachea causing partial occlusion. On January 8th, he ruled the death a homicide. But Ohio State brought in a pathologist from Phoenix, Arizona, and had him examine DeLong's body. This pathologist said that an undertaker might have placed the gauze in DeLong's throat. And Ohio State used this possibility to lambaste Adrian's conclusion that the death was a homicide. The investigators, and now the coroner too, were dumbfounded. For the evidence did not support Ohio State's contention. The gauze bore markings indicating a hospital use. And more significantly, the investigating staff interviewed the mortician who had embalmed DeLong's body, and he said that not only hadn't he left any gauze in DeLong's body, but that he didn't even use that kind of gauze. After Ohio State made its claims, Adrian convened a meeting of the investigative staff and asked for a secret vote on whether the verdict of homicide should be changed. The verdict stood. It seemed that wherever Morgan turned, someone at Ohio State was trying to thwart him. Evidence hadn't been collected or had been discarded. The Goodman and Whitcomb investigations had been disastrous. Swango himself had never even been subjected to a formal interview, nor was any attempt made to reconcile the three inconsistent versions he'd offered of his involvement in the Cooper respiratory failure. Every doubt was resolved in favor of Swango and against the credibility of everyone else. Morgan was so upset that he discussed with Miller whether there was sufficient evidence to consider seeking an indictment of Ohio State officials for obstruction of justice. But they discarded the possibility as unwarranted, politically dangerous, and unsatisfying, given that Swango was the real target. On that score, Morgan's pessimism grew as the months passed and the search for physical evidence proved fruitless. All he had was a strong circumstantial case based on eyewitness testimony. But given that Ohio State had already dismissed most of that testimony as unreliable, a good defense lawyer would easily establish a reasonable doubt of guilt. Although he firmly believed Swango was guilty and a continuing menace to society, Morgan concluded that pursuing criminal charges would end in failure. Hurt and the other investigators reluctantly agreed. Morgan's frustrations with Ohio State were evident in an extensive report he prepared during January and February 1986. 2 years after the incidents involving Swango in the OSU hospitals. Morgan concluded that while numerous university hospitals' employees can place Dr. Michael Swango at or next to the bedsides of patients who suffered unexplainable respiratory arrests, investigators found a total absence of evidence tending to prove a specific intent to cause serious physical harm or death attributable to Dr. Swango. The hospitals made no effort to preserve the various syringes and other physical evidence involved in the incidents. Nor were autopsies conducted in three suspicious cases. And it should be noted that neither the departments of neurosurgery or general surgery conducted a morbidity and mortality conference to review any of the five suspicious deaths discussed in this report. Obviously, if such a conference occurred, it could have led to the discovery of physical evidence and or additional witnesses or statements by Dr. Swango regarding his treatment procedures. One of the most critical factors present in any criminal investigation, Morgan's report continued, is the amount of time that develops between the occurrence of the criminal act and the subsequent investigation. It is obvious that the unusually long delay between incidents and investigation, as detailed in this report, adversely affected any hope to uncover admissible evidence. It cannot be overemphasized that 8 months had passed before the Ohio State University police had even heard the name of Dr. Michael Swango. Thus, it is not surprising that toxicological testing done 1 to 1.5 years after the suspected poisoning would not result in positive findings. In summary, there is no question that there exists circumstantial evidence demonstrating a pattern of possible assaults and or criminal homicides. and this circumstantial scenario also includes a motive. It can be proven that at the time the series of questionable respiratory arrests began, Dr. Swango was in danger of being terminated as a neurosurgery resident, and he had been notified of this fact. Yet, in the absence of evidence of intent, it was within Michael Swango's job description to be with these patients and to treat them using drugs and syringes. Since under Ohio law, conviction on the basis of circumstantial evidence requires that the evidence be wholly inconsistent with any reasonable theory of the defendant's innocence, it is the recommendation of this writer that there be no criminal prosecution of Dr. Michael J. Swango at this time. Morgan gave the 60-page draft to Miller to review, and Miller suggested they show it to Jennings, Ohio State's president. Morgan personally delivered it, and Jennings thanked him and shook his hand. By the end of the day, lawyers were on the phone to Miller with one demand: delete all the names, including those of all the doctors involved. The report was released on April 1, 1986, with doctors identified only by number. As far as Morgan could tell, his report landed with a thud. The press showed scant interest in his conclusions. He believed that most reporters didn't bother to read it. As for Swango himself, Morgan thought, I'll never hear of him again. Charles Ely had been involved in the investigation on behalf of the Ohio State Medical Board. Though all the board's activities are confidential, it is known to have investigated whether Dr. Carey or anyone else at the medical school should have notified it of Swango's suspicious activities, or at least of his arrest in Illinois. Ely prepared a report about 30 pages long on the matter, but he was ordered to turn over his only copy to the board. No action against anyone at Ohio State was taken. Michael Swango's licenses to practice medicine were suspended by Ohio on February 12, 1986, and by Illinois on March 19th. As Morgan was winding up his investigation and putting the finishing touches on his report, Swango began a campaign to rehabilitate his reputation by agreeing to be interviewed by correspondent John Stossel for the ABC News program 2020. The program aired on February 13, 1986, the day after his license was suspended in Ohio. It was the first national exposure Swango received. Swango was interviewed at Centralia Correctional Center in southern Illinois, where he had begun serving his 5-year term on August 27, 1985, and he was calm and collected, occasionally asking the producers for a glass of water. He was neatly dressed in a coat and red tie. 2020 co-host Hugh Downs introduced the segment thus: Dr. Michael Swango's case is an unusual one. The plot could have been lifted from a TV murder mystery. There is a mix of ingredients. Poison tops the list. There's circumstantial evidence and an ending that leaves room for a sequel. Swango was even more adamant than before Judge Cashman that he had been wrongly accused and convicted. First of all, I'm innocent, he began. I could never do any of the things that have been alleged that I have done. I think my whole life speaks for that. Everything I've done in the past, my work both as a paramedic and a doctor, I simply could not have done those things. Why do all these people think you did? Stossel asked. I don't know. I think that some people think I did because they may have been misled by evidence that has no integrity. Stossel brought up Swango's defense that there were ants in his apartment, and Kevin O'Donnell, the pest control expert, said on camera, This ant is never found indoors, particularly in our area. There were about 1,000 of them milling around aimlessly in the kitchen and the living room, and it appeared, in my opinion, that they had been dumped there. Swango replied, You know, I don't know anything about ants. All I know is I had an ant problem, and I took care of it as best I could. As he had in the past, he explained the scrapbooks of death and disasters, which, unfortunately, are part and parcel of, you know, a paramedic's and of medicine in general. As for the recipe cards for poisons, I'm a scientist, I'm a physician, and part of the curriculum is poisoning, toxicology, the symptoms, and how to treat these various illnesses. Asked specifically about whether he put something in anyone's IV tube at Ohio State, Swango replied, I deny any criminal behavior or any violation of the Hippocratic Oath in working in Ohio or working anywhere. The judge said that maybe there are two of you, Stossel continued, quoting Judge Cashman. I think the judge is wrong, Swango replied. The judge is very wrong. He also wanted you to get psychiatric help. Did you ever think of seeing anyone? Absolutely not. He said that thinking that I was guilty. I'm not guilty. I didn't do those things. Stossel pointed out that because of the time he'd already served in the Adams County Jail during his trial and before sentencing, and with time off for good behavior, Swango might be released in another year and a half. Do you know, some people are scared of you, now that you're getting out, he asked. I'm sorry about that, Swango replied. There's certainly no reason for anybody to be scared. None whatsoever. Judge Cashman, for one, wasn't so sure. That Christmas he received a handwritten card wishing him and his family a safe Christmas. It was signed Michael Swango. Chapter 7. Michael Swango was released by the Illinois Department of Corrections on August 21, 1987, after serving 2 years of his 5-year sentence. He remained under Corrections Department supervision for an additional year. Rita Dumas's support had been unwavering throughout his imprisonment. She now gave friends a new explanation for Michael's conviction, that he had been framed by Wayne Johnson because the coroner had feared that Swango, who was far more skilled, would supplant him. Swango and Dumas moved to Hampton, Virginia, a town on the Chesapeake Peninsula near Newport News and Colonial Williamsburg. Both Rita and Michael wanted to begin a new life, away from Quincy, Columbus, and their past. Rita later told friends she had always wanted to live near the ocean as well. But Swango proved unable to escape his past. He applied for a medical license from the state of Virginia and met with the state's licensing committee on August 12th. Citing his felony conviction and the suspension of his Illinois and Ohio licenses, the committee voted to reject his application. Instead of practicing medicine, Swango went to work as a counselor for the Career Development Center, which helped students get into medical and other professional schools. While he was working there, three of his colleagues came down with symptoms suspiciously similar to those experienced by the paramedics in Quincy: sudden nausea, vomiting, and severe headaches. One of them was hospitalized. And despite Swango's relationship with Rita Dumas, a second woman accused him of stalking her after she spurned what she deemed to be sexual advances. She soon became one of the three to experience similar symptoms. Colleagues were already wary of Swango. His obsession with violent death and accidents had survived his confinement in prison. He carried clippings of disasters in a large paper bag and was often seen working on his scrapbooks. Then co-workers discovered that Swango had converted a basement room at the center into living quarters and was frequently spending the night there. He left in May 1989. Acting on a complaint from another employee at the counseling center, the Newport News police launched an investigation of the mysterious illnesses. They soon traced Swango to Columbus, Ohio, and spoke to Prosecutor Morgan's office. Morgan sent them a copy of his report on Swango's activities at Ohio State. The Columbus inquiry also led to a tip to the Columbus Dispatch, which reported that Swango was now under investigation in Virginia. After a friend sent the dispatch article to Swango and Dumas, Swango called the Newport News police and, in an effort to clear himself, asked to be interviewed. No charges were filed, but the investigation into Swango's past seems to have prompted him to begin legal proceedings to change his name. On January 18, 1990, by order of the Circuit Court of York County, Virginia, Swango legally changed his name to David Jackson Adams. Still using his original name, Swango next found work as a lab technician at Atacoal Services, a company that tested samples of coal to be exported to France from the United States. He also worked part-time as a paramedic at a nearby hospital and began taking courses to be certified as an emergency medical technician. No one questioned his references or called anyone in Quincy for further information. Attacole's president, William C. Banks, found Swango to be pleasant and hardworking, an exemplary employee. Swango introduced Banks to Rita Dumas, and Banks thought they made a charming couple. Not long after, Swango asked him for some time off to get married. On July 8, 1989, he and Rita were finally married, nearly 6 years after meeting at Ohio State. Despite his past, Swango had a semblance of a normal, stable life, with a well-paid job and a wife. Yet almost immediately after the wedding, problems surfaced. His relationship with Rita, which had survived so many external strains, rapidly deteriorated. She later confided that she realized almost immediately after marrying Swango that she had made a terrible mistake. Despite his years of purported devotion, he now showed scant interest, either romantic or sexual, in her. He wouldn't sleep in the same bed, and lived almost entirely in one room of the apartment, its den. He was constantly working on his computer and ignored Rita. She also complained that he stole money from her account and refused to contribute any of his earnings toward household expenses. But the breaking point may have come when a clerk at a nearby video rental shop became pregnant. Rita was certain that Michael was the father. In any event, she thought he had been cheating on her with other women. In January 1991, only a year and a half after marrying, Rita and Swango separated, later stating in court that they intended to discontinue permanently the marital cohabitation. Rita resumed use of her maiden name, Brodegard. As Swango's marriage unraveled, some Attacole employees became violently ill. Banks himself had to be hospitalized after suddenly feeling dizzy, nauseated, weak, and sweaty. Another executive lapsed into a near coma after experiencing similar symptoms and also had to be hospitalized. Meanwhile, Swango resumed his quest for employment as a doctor. By early May 1991, Swango, or Adams, as he now was legally named, was in contact with doctors at Ohio Valley Medical Center in Wheeling, West Virginia, about a job opening there. He had to reveal his real name, so it would accord with his medical school record and references. The hospital's chief of medicine, Dr. Jeffrey S. Schultz, later told the Illinois police that Swango claimed that his Illinois medical license had been suspended on account of a single felony/battery conviction, resulting from an altercation occurring in a restaurant. At the time, there was no national clearinghouse for information about doctors convicted of crimes or found liable for malpractice. The American Medical Association kept a master file intended to track errant doctors, and the American Federation of State Medical Associations maintained a list of doctors whose licenses had been suspended by state boards. But neither had any details of Swango's arrest and conviction. In any event, there's no indication Dr. Schultz made any attempt to contact them. Instead, he wrote the state attorney's office in Quincy saying that, "We are considering offering him a position, and we want to be fair to this young man." The letter continued, "Frankly, the severity of his punishment seems out of proportion to the offense committed, based on his description." Dr. Schultz also checked with the Illinois Department of Professional Regulation, the body that had suspended Swango's license, and learned that he had not, in fact, been convicted of battery because of any altercation in a restaurant, but had been convicted of 6 counts of poisoning. Dr. Schultz confirmed this in a phone conversation with the state's attorney in Quincy. It is apparently a measure of Swango's persuasiveness, not to mention one doctor's evident willingness to take the word of another, that the revelations from Illinois did not bring negotiations between Ohio Valley and Swango to a halt. Schultz wrote Swango a letter offering him the opportunity to document his version of events. Swango responded in a letter dated May 20th. "Dear Dr. Schultz, I received your letter of 5/10/91 on Thursday, May 16th, and I've been working constantly since then to try to locate and obtain as soon as possible the copies you've requested. I'm so happy to tell you that via numerous phone calls and FedEx, I've been able to get copies of what you need. I've enclosed 3 sets of copies, so people can have them right away. As we discussed during my interview, I'm prepared to accept a position right away, and I'm truly looking forward to coming to Wheeling and joining your residency program. Thanks again. Sincerely, David J. Adams, M.D. Among the documents Swango provided was a prison discharge fact sheet, which explained the battery as a brawl. "Releasee struck a blow with his fist," the document said. Similarly, a docketing statement contained this description of the case. Appellant was convicted in a bench trial of felony battery, violation of Chapter 38, Illinois Revised Statutes, Section 12-4, intentional application of physical force to an individual with resultant bodily injury caused by said force. In this case, the force was a blow struck by appellant's fist. Appellant was sentenced to a term of 6 months to be followed by 18 months probation. Swango also submitted a 1989 letter from the governor of Virginia, Gerald L. Beliles. Written on the letterhead of the Commonwealth of Virginia, Office of the Governor, it said, "Dear Mr. Swango, I have before me your application for restoration of civil rights, which will restore certain rights forfeited as a result of your felony record. Reputable citizens who are familiar with your conduct since your convictions advise me that you are leading an upright, law-abiding life, and they recommend that your civil rights be restored. Relying on these recommendations, I am removing your political disabilities. I am pleased to convey my actions to you and wish you much success in the future." These and other documents prompted Dr. Schultz to write again to Quincy authorities, this time saying that Swango had submitted copies of court documents which would appear to support his story. Schultz asked for a brief letter indicating the nature of his difficulties, which led to his revocation of his medical license. He attached copies of the documents Swango had submitted. Quincy authorities were both alarmed and amazed. The docketing statement was an outright forgery, a crime in itself. The state of Virginia verifies that Swango's civil rights were indeed restored on December 31, 1989. Scott Walden, the Adams County state's attorney, immediately sent Schultz copies of Swango's sentencing order and of the appellate court opinion rejecting his appeal. He also sent copies of the materials to Judge Cashman, urging that he, too, contact Schultz. In his note to Cashman, Walden wrote, "As you can see, Swango has gone to great lengths to cover up what he has done, even to the point of falsifying documents." The flurry of documents and calls from Quincy finally persuaded Schultz to reject Swango's application. But there's nothing to suggest that doctors at Ohio Valley took any further steps to alert other doctors and medical residency programs to the possibility that Swango might apply. In any event, the rejection did nothing to discourage Swango, who was soon applying for other resident positions. In 1986, while Swango was still serving his prison term in Centralia, Dr. Michael Prince Brody was suspended from practice at John F. Kennedy Memorial Hospital in Indio, California, after an anonymous caller alleged that Dr. Brody had submitted false references and concealed his past. When the hospital investigated, it learned that 5 years earlier, Dr. Brody had been suspended by Bayshore Hospital in Pasadena, Texas, where he was a staff obstetrician, after a series of bizarre incidents that culminated in his being admitted to the emergency room with a stab wound. Brody claimed to have operated on his own abdomen with a pocket knife. Dr. Brody had been suffering a drug problem for years. Nurses reported that he took dexedrine by day and Valium at night, and had actually fallen asleep while performing surgery on a patient. They often had trouble locating him, and he frequently refused to see patients. Long before the stabbing incident, Bayshore Hospital administrators had concluded that he personally abused analgesic, sedative, and stimulant drugs, including amphetamine compounds, benzodiazepine compounds, and opiate compounds, according to a later report. Before being hospitalized for drug treatment, Brody had been regularly seeing patients, treating patients, and making decisions with regard to the welfare of patients, while suffering from an adjustment disorder with mixed disturbance of emotion and conduct, mixed substance abuse, and psychological factors affecting physical conditions, the report continued. In 1980, Brody did not respond to an urgent summons to show up for the delivery of a baby girl. Nor had he arranged for another doctor to cover him in his absence. The infant, Andrea Ferris, suffered brain damage from loss of oxygen and was subsequently awarded $119 million in an out-of-court malpractice settlement, at the time the largest ever awarded in Texas. Brody's hospital privileges at Bayshore were suspended. But after he agreed to undergo psychotherapy and substance abuse treatment, they were reinstated. A month later came the episode in which Brody said he had operated on himself with a pocket knife. His hospital privileges at Bayshore were now revoked, this time for good. But that was hardly the end of Dr. Brody's medical career. No one at Bayshore reported him to state medical authorities, to the American Medical Association, to the Federation of State Medical Boards, or to any other investigative authority. Brody moved on to Hospital in the Pines in Lone Star, Texas, where he again failed to respond to calls to deliver a baby. This time, both mother and child died. The hospital reached an undisclosed settlement with surviving family members, and Dr. Brody resigned. Again, no other disciplinary action was taken. When Dr. Brody applied to renew his Texas medical license in 1982, he responded no when asked whether he had ever been disciplined by a hospital, even though Bayshore had revoked his privileges. His license was renewed. Brody left Texas, was licensed in California, and was hired at JFK Memorial in Indio. His license to practice in Texas was still in effect when JFK suspended him. Brody's is hardly an isolated case. This and other examples of doctors moving from state to state to escape disciplinary action and license suspension were the focus of a June 23, 1986 episode of ABC's Nightline. Asked on the show why he hadn't reported Dr. Brody, a spokesman for Bayshore Hospital said simply, "It's, I don't think, up to me to report these kinds of things to the State Board of Medicine." The medical literature, not to mention the popular press, has been full of accounts of incompetent physicians. In 1986, the New York Times quoted medical officials to the effect that 5 out of every 100 doctors are so incompetent, drunk, senile, or otherwise impaired that they should not be practicing medicine without some form of restriction. A medical director of the Kaiser Foundation Health Plan testified in Congress in 1986 that 3 to 5% of the nation's 425,000 practicing physicians have an impairment of some degree from a wide variety of causes. Even when hospitals or state licensing boards take action against incompetent doctors, they usually do so quietly, often in confidence, as they did with Swango. The result, concluded Robert Adler, counsel to the U.S. House of Representatives Subcommittee on Health and the Environment, charged with regulating the medical profession, is a group of rogue physicians who are free to leave the immediate hospital or jurisdiction and continue their practice elsewhere. While Nightline brought the Brody case to the attention of a national audience and eventually to that of lawmakers in Washington, the problem of rogue doctors would no doubt have gone unaddressed had the medical community itself not reacted as strongly as it did to an Oregon case. In 1981, several of Dr. Timothy Patrick's colleagues at Columbia Memorial Hospital in Astoria, Oregon, alleged that he was incompetent and recommended that his hospital privileges be suspended. These same doctors had earlier invited the surgeon to join them in their practice at a local clinic. Instead, Patrick started a competing practice of his own. After they tried to revoke his hospital privileges, Patrick sued the doctors, claiming they were trying to maintain a monopoly by shutting down his practice. A federal district court jury agreed with Dr. Patrick and awarded him $650,000, which under federal antitrust laws was trebled to nearly $2 million in damages. The result outraged the medical profession, and not because Dr. Patrick had been mistreated by his fellow physicians. Many doctors felt the verdict threatened the peer review process. As they saw it, doctors who tried to discipline a colleague for incompetence had instead been punished themselves. Peer review, the evaluation of practicing physicians by other physicians, is the foundation of the disciplinary process within the medical profession, and has been at least since 1760, when doctors were first licensed in the United States. The notion is that only doctors can evaluate the quality of patient care, a principle that the American Medical Association has championed with near-religious zeal. This deeply ingrained tradition was no doubt part of the reason that Ohio State doctors resisted calling the police to investigate Swango, and they openly acknowledged their fears of being sued. In the wake of the Patrick verdict, doctors argued vociferously that his case and several similar ones were making it all but financially ruinous for doctors to try to dismiss an incompetent physician. When the Patrick case went to the U.S. Supreme Court, the AMA argued that doctors who seek to discipline other doctors they consider incompetent should not be put at risk of huge damage awards for which insurance is not available, when a jury can be convinced their motives were not pure, according to the New York Times. And the AMA lobbied for federal legislation exempting doctors from the nation's antitrust laws to eliminate the possibility that doctors could be sued for terminating another doctor's privileges or suspending a license. But the AMA's sudden interest in strengthening the peer review process by insulating doctors from liability struck many as disingenuous, for the profession's efforts to police itself had always been lax. While the logic of peer review has never been seriously questioned, its effectiveness has. In a 1988 study, Timothy Jost, a law professor at, of all places, Ohio State, concluded that there is substantial evidence that, despite its potential, the medical staff peer review system has traditionally operated quite laxly. It is never a comfortable task to sit in judgment on one's peers, with whom one works on a day-to-day basis. A physician in this position must always deal with the temptation to give the benefit of the doubt and gloss over a colleague's errors. State medical licensing boards are largely an extension of the peer review process. Though the boards may include at least token non-doctors, they are dominated by physicians. They suffer from all the problems of peer review boards in hospitals, not to mention restricted budgets, lack of time for contested hearings, and inadequate investigative staffs. These problems all surfaced in Ohio. In April 1985, in the wake of the Swango case and the Ohio State Medical Board's failure to take any disciplinary action against anyone at Ohio State, Plain Dealer reporter Gary Webb published an exhaustive 7-part series on the effectiveness of the Ohio Board, which showed that the lapses in the Swango case were hardly exceptional. Among the series' conclusions, all of them backed up with numerous examples, the Ohio Board allowed doctors convicted of felonies such as drug trafficking, insurance fraud, forgery, theft, sexual assault, and drug abuse to remain in practice. The board allowed physicians with serious alcohol or drug problems to remain in practice, even perform surgery while they were undergoing treatment, withdrawal, and psychotherapy. The board allowed doctors diagnosed as suffering severe mental problems to remain in practice for years while their cases wended their way through the board's hearing process. The board routinely allowed doctors convicted of felonies to continue practicing for years while their cases dragged on in appellate courts. Even when a physician repeatedly violated the law, the board seemed loath to pull his or her license. Board members worried that the physician would be unable to earn a living. While ignoring some physician crimes, the board kept its small staff of 6 investigators busy digging up evidence against nurse midwives, physician's assistants, health food stores, chiropractors, acupuncturists, masseuses, manicurists, and others suspected of practicing medicine without a license. The Plain Dealer also chastised the board for the use of secret hearings and deals negotiated privately with the offending doctor, noting that virtually everything about the board's procedures is confidential. The board repeatedly rebuffed my requests for information about their investigations of Swango and Ohio State's handling of the matter on grounds of confidentiality.
Keep quiet, keep quiet, keep quiet. Katherine Massey Book Club, Context of White Supremacy. That would be audio segment 1. Gary Webb. Gary Webb. We'll pick up in audio segment 2 in chapter 7. The Plain Dealer series made clear, as have numerous academic and legislative studies, that the effectiveness of state licensing boards at weeding out incompetent physicians has always been inadequate. That's what we'll pick up at for audio section two. The number to dial, 605-313-5164. The code, 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code, 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email, untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. If you have thoughts, observations on the text, before I get to emails, callers, notes, I was doing the, or I guess two things. First, if anyone can locate, get access to, if you can find it online or whatever, any of these Nightline segments that they are referencing from the mid, late 1980s, early 90s, would love to see them. Going to talk to Swango, some of the other doctors that they talked to about the incompetence and their unwillingness or reticence to discipline rogue doctors, as they say. I would love to check out some of this archival footage, especially now with all the talk about Lucy Letby and even Savior Complex and on and on and on, that this has been a long problem that white people are very aware of. Two, if we have any folks, or not, I guess it's all related. So that would be one part, the Nightline segment. And then specifically for the Plain Dealer, I have many of the reports for the Plain Dealer, but I'm on the opposite side of the continent from Ohio. So if you can access the Plain Dealer for 1985 and 86, I would love to see the 7-part series that they did. I'm looking at some of the articles right here, but the Plain Dealer, they are kind of stingy with the information. Many of the other newspapers you can access for free online. They want you to pay what I think is, you know, pretty high sum for talking about 40 years old reports, but are still noteworthy. But if you can access the Plain Dealer 1985-86, I would love to get that 7-part series that they did on Dr. Rogue Doctors and OSU's inept investigating of all of this. That would be great supplementary material. And my attention was so absorbed, I saw this, like, that was right at where we ended the audio for chapter one. They're talking about the 7-part series in the Plain Dealer, which is the Cleveland newspaper, Ohio. Gary Webb doing this big series on these doctors and all. And I heard that name. It's like, Gary Webb? Gary Webb? Is that the same Gary Webb who wrote Dark Alliance? The book that alleges that the CIA was trafficking cocaine and crack? Is that the same Gary Webb? I go look. Indeed, it is the same Gary Webb. I was stunned. And even on top of that, he didn't just write that book, Dark Alliance, and a number, this is a white journalist, he's deceased, a number of other reports about CIA is trafficking drugs. This is all racism. Dark Alliance, that's the book. He also wrote a series of reports about 20 years after all of this on Swango and everything in Ohio. He wrote a series of reports on the California Highway Patrol terrorizing black motorists. I was stunned. And now they have a documentary on the same Gary Webb, killed the messenger. He committed suicide some years back, more than a decade ago. And they have a documentary now talking about basically he was accurate. Yes, CIA trafficking drugs. And, you know, they discredited him. Oh, my God. No, kept talking about rogue white man out here lying on the CIA and ought to be ashamed of yourself and all the rest of it. And now, oh, dang, maybe he was correct. And, oh, dang, even before, oh, I think he might have wrote that report about the California Highway Patrol before it was really popular to say all the driving while black and everything. Maybe, don't quote me on that, but I mean, this is like 2007, talking like 15 years ago. Absolutely amazed. We might even have to interrupt our intro next week to go back and add in a little Gary Webb. That's why I said I wanted to see what he wrote, because he has such a stunning, noteworthy journalistic career to think that it all goes back to Ohio and Michael Swang. Did he point out that Rena Cooper was a black female that they just summarily dismissed? Maybe even her roommate too, Iwonya Utz? Reading more important than watching television. I know we have some listeners, they do know the book Dark Alliance because they say we should have read that in conjunction with O.J. Simpson and Labyrinth about the murder of Tupac Shakur, that all of that, Rodney King even, all of that in context. California history indeed. Dark Alliance. Incredible. Gary Webb. Anyway, number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let's see, we'll get one email and then we'll nab folks dialed in. They have comments, observations, questions, all that good stuff. Let's see. Email number one. So far, an excellent, greetings Gus caller, so far an excellent addition to the book club. The information could be helpful in protecting yourself in the workplace from false accusations if you work directly with patients. We do have folks who are in the medical field. I don't know if they've made any changes and what have you to try to prevent this sort of thing. Michael Swangos from taking advantage, maybe they have what? Security cameras, certainly, and maybe they have better, you know, I don't know, access, eyes, I don't know what you would do, in terms of stopping this sort of thing, protecting yourself from accusations, log everything, that would be a lot of it. I don't know if folks that have other tips, but man, it doesn't seem like they have put in too many better safeguards to even stop this sort of thing from happening. It doesn't seem like. That was the clip that we started with today. Dr. Byrne continues, chapter 6, page 128. Parents of the young gymnast Cynthia Ann McGee had quietly accepted monetary settlements from Ohio State. Was Rena Cooper a part of any monetary settlement? Great question. Black female, did she get any money for all of this? Did they admit? Now, see, Cynthia Ann McGee, she died. They have lots of reports on her now and pictures. This is a young white woman, I think might be blonde white woman. They say, oh man, we killed her. Rena Cooper lives, so it might, you didn't even die. Get on out of here. Crazy black woman, get on out of here. Number two, when he discovered that ricin poison, Cooperman called his attorney and they decided to notify the coroner. Cooperman thus became the first and only doctor at Ohio State to initiate contact with an investigative authority outside the hospital. This physician may still be alive in Columbus. What? That's crazy. That's crazy. Wow. I have to think about that. Maybe we can chat it up with him. Wow. That would be interesting to get his thoughts on this case all these years. See, do you think things have changed? Kind of stop all this, keep this from happening, and this case is still talked about all these years later. They're still doing documentaries and such on the Swango case. Have to see. Let's see. Number three. Morgan went to some lengths to determine the basis for the hospital's conclusion that Cooper had been paranoid and thus potentially delusional. Reported that Cooper had accused the OSU neurologist, Dr. George Paulson, of trying to burglarize her home. They fabricated that burglar story. She's just a crazy... black woman. I mean, master deceivers, for sure. Master deceivers. But this anecdote right here, where they had just, that's what I just said, summarily dismissed Miss Cooper. She's crazy. She ought to get on out of here. You know, crazy black woman. Yeah. Same thing for her roommate, who we think also could be a black person. I want your uts. Get on out of here. She's crazy. She's got brain problems. Yeah, yeah. Get on out of here. And then so when he goes, he says, well, wait a minute. How did you all conclude that they're crazy? I know they're negros, you know, but I mean, for reals, why do you think they're crazy? Oh, you know. She said that Dr. Paulson, you know, broke into her house and stole her lamp. You know, that's keeps breaking her out. What? Even he said that he went and asked Dr. Paulson. He said, what? I don't remember, you know, anybody ever saying that she thought I broke into her house. That seems crazy. I don't even have her address. You can make up anything about black people. And I mean anything. Anything. And you see the converse with Michael Swango. He is a convicted felon. He can lie and say whatever he wants to. Oh, no, I didn't. What you mean, poison? Oh, no. I just got an old bar fight. You know, we were watching the game and my team lost. I bet a whole lot of money and, oh, it just got out of it. Oh, yeah, it happens to the best of us. No problem. Didn't even check his references. Black person, they lie on you. Well, and she did have her house burglarized, but they just flipped out on her. Well, you know, she lied, said that we broke into her house and stole her turnip greens. You know, these niggers, you can't trust them. Everybody just accepts that. Yep. Crazy, delusional, blamed us for trying to kill her and breaking her house. Even I have to pause. We did hear about a white nurse. She was afraid that she was going to be attacked while she was at home. Said, I'm even scared going out and walking my dog. So apparently, it's not that far beyond the pale that, dang, maybe then one of these doctors would come and attack me at my, they're stealing drugs and all the rest of it. I mean, dang, is it that far? Anyway, get off into that. Number four, Morgan was so upset that he discussed with Miller whether there was sufficient evidence to consider seeking an indictment of Ohio state officials for obstruction of justice, but they discarded the possibility as unwarranted, politically dangerous, and unsatisfying, given that Swango was the real target. Since there were no consequences for the authorities at OSU Medical Center, is there any reason to believe that similar cover-ups have not happened subsequently? Great question, and he said politically dangerous. What does that mean? Politically dang? What does that mean? What do you mean? You mean like there could be trouble for pursuing? Did you obstruct? I mean, police came when Swango was going on trial for felony battery, and they didn't cooperate with the investigation. That sounds like obstruction of justice. Are you going to make the files available? We heard this week, like, we set up the interviews. We do it proper so we don't disrupt the patients. Be professional about it. Doctors don't even show up to appointments. In fact, they said they would send some of the doctors out of town when it was time for their interview. All of that. Obstruction of justice. But why would acknowledging we made some, why would that be dangerous? Who is the danger? Walter White, like, whom is the danger? Buckeye State, indeed, and even unsatisfying. Why would it be unsatisfying? Don't we want to find out the truth of all this? Don't we want to prevent this from happening? Didn't he say that at the end? It could have been years of this. Could be. Lucy Letby. Never know. Mastered. And man, the whiteness of all of this cannot be minimized. If the doctors look like you, I mean, I keep saying, if this was 00 Welsing, come on, man. Some white people would pay. You didn't let that nigga woman come in here and do what? And she killed a white gymnast? What? white people would have paid. They would have had a serious criminal investigation if 00 Welsing, 00 Ben Carson had done something like this. And you had routine behavior like this from Negro doctors. Come on. 5. Morgan's frustrations with Ohio State were evident in an extensive report, 1986. I would love to get this report to you. They have it at Ohio State. If somebody gets a digital copy, share. No effort to preserve the various syringes and other physical evidence involved in the incidents. Neither the department's neurosurgery or general surgery conducted a morbidity and mortality conference to review any of the 5 suspicious deaths. They knew that the rules did not apply to them. We make the rules. I think I might avoid OSU, but then again, there is no place to run. Can't say that one enough. There is no place to run. No place to hide for non-white victims in a global system of racism, white supremacy. Swango ends up in a rural part of Zimbabwe. The great Joe Lewis, illiterate, the great Joe Lewis said, you can run, but you can't hide. Genius. Number 6. Delete all the names, including those of all the doctors involved. The report 1986 with doctors identified only by number. As far as Morgan could tell, his report landed with a thud. The press showed scant interest in his conclusions. He believed that most reporters didn't bother to read it. Why do I find that very believable? I don't think this is like a War and Peace size report, meaning I don't think it's 1,000 pages or 800 pages and really small font. I think they said it's less than 70 pages. You could probably read it in one sitting. Nah. Cosby Show on? Let's go watch that. Clearly, interests of the doctors and authorities at OSU are more important than the general public. In fact, do you remember earlier when they said it came out in the paper, some of the first allegations about Swango at OSU, they said the doctors ran out and bought all the papers up and snatched them all up so nobody would see it. You think they might have done the same thing when that report came out? They went around and got as many of the papers as they could? Anyway, 7. Swango might be released in another year and a half. Judge Cashman, that Christmas, he received a handwritten card wishing him and his family a safe Christmas. It was signed Michael Swango. If I were that judge, I would have checked into his probation requirements after release and make it longer after that card, which I found threatening. I didn't think of it until he wrote that, like, ooh wee, do we need to check this for anthrax? wait a minute. I don't even want to touch it. Wait a minute. Get the bomb squad and I was thinking he shouldn't have access to that in the prison, but he was in a low-security prison. He's a doctor. He can get in there and, you know, scientist up something. Like, come on. Chapter 7. Wait a minute. Make sure I didn't get too far ahead. Oh, yep, we got that far. All right. Chapter 7. Michael Swango was released by the Illinois Department of Corrections on August 21, 1987, after serving 2 years of his 5-year sentence. Seems like the Department of Corrections should have kept tabs on him, probation, for more than a year after release. We've heard this before, too. This happened with Jeffrey Dahmer after his original arrest conviction, child molestation, where he really wasn't followed that much. And that seems to be a pattern with white offenders, where they have a record and all this, and Yeah. 2. We want to be fair with this young man. The letter continued. Frankly, the severity of his punishment seems out of proportion to the offense committed based on his description. The word fair is used so often in the system of racism, white supremacy. Maybe it just sticks out because I look for it. In any event, it seems like it is one of the most important words in the English language. I agree. And because it comes, it's not just the frequency, although that's true too, it is the import. This is such a significant moment. Like, oh, we got this discrepancy, and oh man, we don't want to niggerize him. Oh, man, we want to be fair. Now, if it had been 00 Welsing, he had a felony all year. You think it would have been, we want to be fair with old 00 Welsing. Three, Dr. Brody had been suffering a drug problem for years, fallen asleep while performing surgery. Infant Andrea Ferris suffered brain damage, awarded $119 million, agreed to undergo psychotherapy and substance abuse treatment. They were reinstated, operated on himself with a pocket knife. A few years ago, a prominent suspected racist physician in my local area was arrested after a high-speed chase. Tested positive for methamphetamine and marijuana. He is currently back at his old job treating patients. No. White people don't get fired. Let's see. Number three, peer review the evaluation of practicing physicians. Oh, didn't get that far. We'll pause there and resume. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Other folks who dialed in, let's see, Fresh Princess of Philly should be with us. Nab other hands as I see them.
Oh, my. There are just so many things in this text that remind me of personal experiences that I've had. So that involves...
Let's see, Fresh Princess, you sound a little distant, like you're far from your receiver. Is it possible you can get a little bit closer?
Yeah, okay. So I'm not sure if you were aware, but you may be experiencing some interference on your tuning because it's the interview with the gentleman from Buffalo that was at the top grocery store that was playing. So I also dialed in on my phone. So just to make you aware of that. But I emailed you yesterday about my personal experience with medical cover-up. I can't speak to it publicly because, unfortunately, I am a victim of white supremacy. And I was complicit in something that I should have raised to awareness, but please keep in mind of where I was doing my postgraduate research. I spoke actually to a soulful yesterday who was a physician at that same hospital who said her hair and her eyebrows fell out, unfortunately, during the 3 years she was there. But if the university or medical institution does not want to bring to light accusations of wrongdoing, in my experience, they will find a way to put that back on the patient, and they will fund research to find other variables that may have affected the patient's outcome. It's from this reading, it seems like that is a common practice among institutions, and it can't be avoided, especially if you are a non-white Black person. It is, in my opinion, it's best to have someone with some medical knowledge if you go to any appointment or know that you're going to any appointment, even if you know a medical assistant. Some people have been medical assistants for like 20 years. They know a ton. Consult them. Have them come to the hospital for you. You just don't know how many available opportunities there are to violate your personal rights that avail themselves to people whose bottom line is to make money. And to me, the hospitals were more engaged in making money than exposing someone who should not have been a physician. So I end my call with that. Thank you.
Much obliged for sharing. Thank you for letting me know. Tune in was messing up. I don't know if I did something, smacked the button or didn't or what have you, but it is corrected. Should be working now for Fresh Princess or anybody else. If you're having tune in issues, refresh. You can try it again and should be working. Thank you kindly for letting me know. Did you, is this, how shall I phrase it? Because this is big, this problem is much larger than Michael Swango. That's why she gave those suggestions. That's why we spoke with Dr. Kaplan. Is this, I don't know, is this talked about? Because you said, you know, like even personally being involved in this where you should have said something and we're victims, pretty powerless.
That's... So I'll put it to you like this. The position I had was a postgraduate research opportunity. And I made a particular physician so much money that within the institution, he had my profile flagged in human resources. So any job I applied to, they automatically rejected me. I applied outside of the institution, and because I was giving department heads names, I kept not getting jobs. I had another white physician pull me aside that was his rival that said, if you want to get out of here, use me as a reference. It goes deep. Wow. And that's how I got out. So,
oh, sorry.
You can't say anything. When I was tasked to do what I wrote you about, I did it. I actually had someone at the hospital, non-black person, when I had to go meet with them about what I was doing to build out the database. They said, he doesn't usually hire people who look like you. And I said, you mean pretty? And he said, no, black. So, there you go.
Dang. White lab coat. Dang. Dang. Well, take someone with you. And if you have access, consult someone who has some medical expertise where you can just ask questions.
I want to tell my story. I was in almost near fatal car accident this past April. We were taken by ambulance to Johns Hopkins. So by ambulance, almost near fatal car accident, you think that you're going to get treatment soon. I sat in the ER for 8 hours until my blood pressure dropped to dangerously low levels. My sternum was cracked. If no one knows what the sternum is, from the seatbelt, it's your chest bone, the middle part. I didn't get not even a Tylenol for 14 hours. My friend who was also in the car, she sat in the ER for 14 hours. She had internal bleeding. They ended up having to keep her. But the whole time we were there, people kept coming in and out of the room. After I got finally taken back, you want an HIV test? You want an HIV test? You want an HIV test? Literally, like everybody that came in that room asked the same question. I could barely breathe. But people were asking me, did I want an HIV test? From my experience there, knowing what I know, That was a research study. The consent was not being done properly. I'm in an industry that I'm in to prevent what was pricked upon my heart when I went to pharmacy school. So I know when people are trying to backdoor a consent, and I was privy to backdoor consent. So I know how some institutions do. You have to be very careful. It also happened to my mother when she went for hand surgery consultation. They stuck some papers in the middle. And I said, no, she doesn't want to be part of a research study. And when I called the office, they said, well, nobody ever tells us no. The people who are in charge, really, of clinical research are your clinical research coordinators. They are your study nurses. The PIs are supposed to be overseeing people, but they don't really care. They're too busy seeing patients. Believe it or not, physicians are salaried employees. They make money based upon their patient volume, based upon their insurance reimbursement, blah, blah, blah. How they make extra money now, and I'm putting myself in a ton to saying this, is clinical research. And a lot of them don't care about the actual research because they have people under them who do. So take somebody to the hospital with you. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Much obliged, Fresh Princess. That is going to come up in the text later on. An ethical research, specifically with Swango, but that is going to come up in the book. Stay tuned. Other folks who dialed in, if we missed you totally, if you have commentary to share, shout out to Fresh Princess Mommy as well. Other folks who dialed in, proceed.
Can I be heard?
Non-Clemson dad. Heard both of y'all. I guess we'll get non-Clemson dad because I heard him first.
Okay, well, I'll be quick. Listening to this part of the broadcast, you know, the fact that, for example, in one of those reports, they said that they wanted to remove the names of the doctors who was reviewing 00 Swango's file was very interesting. Recently, I had to do a continual education for my planning certificate. And one of the, and you know, sometimes, you know, most of these professional organizations, they have code of conduct and ethics. And one of the ones that changed recently was the idea that someone, especially when you're certified or you have some kind of professional certification, at least in one of them, if you see something and you do not say something, you are considered legally liable when something goes wrong. And with all the things that everyone clearly suspected 00 Swango of doing, yet these doctors kept going out of the way to remove, to say he was doing a good job or saying that they didn't want their names attached to the investigation is not only telling, but I would also go as far as to say that they are potentially legal because they were also investigating him and came to the conclusion that he's clearly doing something, but they would not act. But I imagine no one ever got in trouble when they were investigating him as, you know, doctors themselves while but looking the other way. With that, I'll mute my line.
It's not called looking the other way. It's called blind eye. Lauren did tell us about that, where she said, that's kind of passive. Even looking the other way is more active, might be a more accurate reflection of what they did, not blind eye, but looking the other way to make money and in some instance to practice white supremacy, racism. I don't think they would look the other way if it had been 00 Welsing, 00 Ben Carson. The taking the names out of the report, too, I thought was, wow. I mean, buddy, that is white supremacy refinement at it, what they call redactions. And also, I thought I could encapsulize it in one book at the hands of persons unknown. That's normally what they do for the lynch part. Who did it? At the hands of, at the white hands of persons unknown. White code for centuries. Thank you for your patience. Our caller 2979, proceed.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings, guests, and to the callers. This is my first time calling in about the book. I've been trying to catch up, but I've been listening to this. I just wanted to quickly speak about the doctors dealing with other doctors, because I have an experience from my job. I work at a medical university in compliance, and one of the processes that I was required to implement was to check medical licenses and to check whether doctors were on the exclusion list. So the exclusion list being doctors can get excluded for committing fraud or really entities. And if they're found on that list and you're essentially partnering with them or paying them with dollars you get from the federal government, you can get in trouble for that and have to pay all kinds of fines. But so this was about 2 years ago, and I remember kind of bringing it up, like, oh, I think we should kind of do this check. And one of the white females I was talking to about it, she kind of played it down. I guess I would say minimized it and said, you know, the hospital where most of these doctors work at, you know, they do the check there, so we don't, it doesn't really make sense for us to do it. Anyway, I went ahead and started doing my own check because I don't communicate with the hospital across the street, you know, and we still have doctors at our medical university. And within doing my first medical license check, there was a doctor on staff who had gotten a judgment because he had gotten caught practicing while being intoxicated. And he actually wasn't allowed to supervise students. And, you know, unless I had done that check, nobody would have known about that. And, you know, coming out of that, part of the application for when these doctors would receive faculty appointments at our university, at the university, is they have to fill out an application, kind of go through a process. And because of that check, a new part of the application was that they're supposed to check the medical license, their medical licenses. And that's public record. You know, all you need is pretty much their name and their medical license number to check it on a government website. So, you know, fast forward the second year, because I did an annual audit where I check it myself. But every time a new faculty member or physician wants to become a faculty member, the medical education department is supposed to be checking them. Fast forward a year later, come to find out that they never implemented the check, and they still weren't doing the check. So I do my second audit, and I found a doctor who received a judgment for sexual harassment in one of his clinics against an assistant. And when I find the checks, you know, I flag a couple of these physicians with the ones that have, you know, these flags, and essentially the committee is supposed to come together and they're supposed to decide what do we do with these physicians, essentially. You know, and these are other doctors at the university. So again, doctors dealing with doctors. So the first year with the first one, we found, okay, it was pretty straightforward. You just take him off. He can't supervise students, but, you know, he still retains his faculty appointment. The second year, they had recommended that we stop checking for the medical licenses, and that, you know, other universities don't do the check. So, you know, they don't see any value in doing the checks. You know, my job was to do the checks and notify them that, hey, this person has a red flag. this is what they did. You need to be aware of it. So, you know, listening to the section in the book and kind of how this, how these white doctors, these racist suspects pretending to be doctors kind of keep getting away with this. And, you know, they keep finding themselves in different areas and they're able to keep getting the job. And these other physicians are so-called protecting them. I thought it was interesting. It kind of makes sense to me as to why there was that push to get rid of that process. Because I thought the thing that was most important to me, or one of the things that I thought of, was do the students know about the physicians essentially that they're being taught by? Like, do they know that they have these judgments, that they're incompetent, that they're practicing under the influence, stuff like that? So yeah, that's what I wanted to call in and comment about. Thanks for taking my call.
Much obliged, sir. That is fascinating. If these folks are teaching, like, dang, you were drunk during the sit. Wait a minute now. I don't know how I feel about swangoing, and then you're going to grade my test and tell me about some ethics, and don't be out there swangoing in between the exam. Like, wait a minute, man, you were drunk during the surgery, man. But come on, man. Come on. Fascinating. This is all still a massive problem per the audio that we started today. Dr. Byrne, November of this month, that was reported. A massive problem. These white doctor killers. Get in some of my quick notes before we get to the second audio segment. One, I thought it was so significant that this book does not have like a slew of footnotes and references throughout. There is a reference section in the end, but he does not give the title of that New York Times report where they're talking about all these drunk and senile doctors and all the rest of it. The title is State Medical Boards Disciplined Record Number of Doctors in 85 by Joel Brinkley. This is the New York Times. This is November 9, 1986. And it is very detailed. It's, you know, a pretty lengthy report, and it even gives statistics by state about the number of doctors who faced disciplinary action. And so this report is from almost 40 years ago and talking about how much of a problem this has been. And again, this goes to that notion that Lucy Letby or Swango or any of these other white doctors, white nurses, whatever it is, that this is an aberration, that this is some one bad apple metaphor. Not by far. Let's see. This section started. The prosecuting attorney said that Swango had been a poised and seemingly earnest witness. That means he's a good liar. In Morgan's opinion, he had been smooth, good-looking, could see why women fell for him. Come on. Come on. Blue-eyed, smooth, good-looking white man. We don't even have to check his references. Very next sentence, had Swango opted for a trial by jury, the prosecutor wasn't sure he would have been convicted. One of our listeners did say that last week, as did Gus T. Like, whoever allowed him to let a judge make the verdict in this case? Like, are you serious? Come on. Let's see. The monetary settlement we got. Oh, and then they included in the settlement with the parents of Cynthia Ann McGee, the white gymnast, that in order for them to speak with the police about their daughter's death, murder potentially, they had to get a subpoena. That is Godfather, like Tom Hegan concierge, stroke of refinement. Woo! Let's see. And then they do all the disruption when they have the interviews for the doctors where they don't show up on time. White people are all about time is money, punctuality, and they don't show up. They send them out of the country when it's time to talk and all that. Already talked about Rena Cooper and one, did she get a settlement? And then she is not ignorant and stupid and all the rest of it. Let's see. the, again, we get the emphasis that it was a young, blonde-haired white person in a white coat doing all of this, where when we finally get a sincere investigation, it seems, I won't you Utz, Rena Cooper, that they are credible. They are believable. They are not talking crazy. They do have something reasonable to say that would seem to suggest Swango was killing folks and or at least trying to. Let's see. Again, they don't check any of the syringes. I mean, this is evidence. We could have cleared all of this up. We got the syringes right here. Oh, it's what it's supposed to be. What are you talking about? Get out of here, making up lies and such on this good white man. Or you don't even say, like, come on, come on. Same type of thing with Columbine. Key evidence is missing and lost. Let's see. Oh, and the detecting the presence of poisons or paralyzing drugs proved a daunting and frustrating task. Even with all the amazing medical advances and technological advances, that is still true in many instances, especially if time has passed between, you know, when the person died or whatever took place. And we're trying to go back and, you know, figure out if that's what happened and exhuming a body. That's why the Tylenol murders in Chicago, 7 people died. It is still unsolved. That's why people like, yes, poisoning for perfect crime. Can be. Right now, why, as we're reading this, many people in the world are paying attention to that case in Australia where a white woman is accused of poisoning her whole family, killing 2 people with the mushrooms. Right as we were starting this book, that became a big to-do. People watching that, like, she's not in jail, but suspected. Poison can be the perfect crime. Let's see. The Ohio State University, this is a multi-billion dollar institution. You don't just have a medical department. They got the new oncology ward. They have a neurosurgery department where they can easily conduct morbidity and mortality conference. Get everybody really comfortable chairs, nice big table. We get out photocopies for everybody. We get out the big, you know, projector screen, and we look at all the evidence. We could take 2-3 days, have catered food, lots of great coffee, scones, and we'll go. They didn't even do that. Pass him on down the road with glowing recommendations. Let's see. Oh, and they even included, Mama C had told us that it seemed like he was doing a lot of retaliatory attacks. They included in the Meeks report, the Morgan investigation, that evidence that there was possible homicides, attempted homicides, and motive. It can be proven that at time, the series of questionable respiratory arrests began. Dr. Swango was in danger of being terminated as a neurosurgery resident, and he had been notified of this fact. We had talked about him, you know, this is how he's kind of going to take it out, lash out. The lawyers make sure no names go in it. I thought it was important, too, that nobody at OSU notifies the Ohio State Medical Board about all of this, since they have direct information. He's, you know, licensed. Why didn't you go and tell other white people? No snitching again. Let's see. Again, I would love to see the Nightline and or the ABC 2020 program where he, you know, testifies about all of this, gives his own side of the story. I do think this dude has been accused of killing folks, and he's sending you, have a safe Christmas. Don't you think that's passive aggressive? Let's see. They have public articles where Rita Duma's, you know, old Swango is innocent. He didn't do it. He's been bamboozled, railroaded. I guess she was too. There are a lot of articles in the Daily. That's the name of the Newport News paper. They have two, but I think that's, or at least that's one. But there you have many articles on Swango, and many of them were published after the release of this book, where it seemed like they started to figure it out and what happened retroactively, and even accusing him of some other murders. He poisoned other coworkers. Lots of details if you want to do more digging. Let's see. They include some while he was working there. Three of his colleagues came down with symptoms suspiciously similar to those experienced by paramedics in Quincy, sudden nausea, all of that. Again, and despite Swango's relationship with Rita Dumas, a second woman accused him of stalking her after she spurned what seemed to be sexual advances. She soon became one of the three to experience similar symptoms. That seems to be a big pattern. If you upset me, you had better not eat or drink anything in the vicinity. Watch your back. And your front. And your T. Changes his name to David Jackson Adams. Master deceiver. And he keeps getting all these jobs at the paramedics. Like, dang. If you're a smooth-talking, good-looking white man, whew, they say the world is your oyster. You're a convicted felon. I'm a smooth-talking, good-looking white man. Felony shmelony. Let's see. He's not even interested. All of this, his lack of interest in Rita Dumas, she's stayed with him through his jailbird years and all the rest of it. He's not even interested in her. I'm interested in killing. Get my potions together. Get my ricin. Get my castor beans together. That's what I'm doing. I don't care about hanging out with you. I'm not interested in being no loving husband, making up for lost time, snuggling, being close to a female after all those years locked up with dudes, criminal dudes at that. No. Do some killing. Think about who wronged me. Like, come on. What does it mean to be white? Let's see. And as Swango's marriage unraveled, some Atticoal employees became violently ill. Banks himself had to be hospitalized. He's the one who hired him. Feeling dizzy, nauseated, weak, and sweaty, another executive lapsed into a near coma after experiencing similar symptoms. Like, Jesus, come on. You have so many of these folks who do not have access seemingly to his information or don't care to or doesn't matter. His deception with these documents, I cannot understate that. This is happening 30, 40 years before the type of widespread, easy, cheap, readily available printing and online technology that would have been available at that time. And he's able to go and get all this. Man. What does it mean to be white? And, like I said, if it had been a Renthal James, felony conviction, bang, that would have been you checked the felony box? What is there to talk about, man? What do you mean be fair? You checked the box, man. They got whole campaign. You checked the box. Maybe if this was chicken nuggets, maybe. You can come in and, you know, let's hear your story. I mean, if we're really hurting, like, okay, we'll put you on the chicken nuggets. But, I mean, to be a doctor, anything healthcare related, you are a convicted felon. Why is it we gotta, let me hear your story. And then he gets all his fake documents. Wow. He calls up the, in Quincy, are you all sure? You sure? Because this white man, this smooth-talking, good-looking, blue-eyed white man, like, are you sure? And even then, he says, the officials, they don't alert the authorities. This is a crime. He's forging federal documents. Why? No snitching. And that's just transferring him on down the road. Somebody else can deal with this or whatever. Sorry, you can't have a job here. Let's see. Yeah, Gary Webb. I can't say that enough. Gary Flippin' Webb. I have got to see what he wrote about all of this dark, that the person who did a 7-part series on all of this with the doctors and Swango and all of that, CIA selling crack, California Highway Patrol terrorizes black people. Stunning. We'll get to audio segment number two. Man, I think this book is so important. Hopefully folks are learning, getting something from James B. Stewart, not turning the other way, blind, or not looking the other way, blind eye. Katherine Massey Book Club, Context of White Supremacy.
The Plain Dealers series made clear, as have numerous academic and legislative studies, that the effectiveness of state licensing boards at weeding out incompetent physicians has always been inadequate. As Legislative Counsel Adler put it in a 1991 survey of the boards. Yet any congressional move to replace or modify peer review has been summarily dismissed because of opposition from the medical profession. Doctors' outrage over the Patrick verdict was rooted in the notion that a jury had slapped the Astoria physicians with a $2 million verdict simply because they had blown the whistle on an incompetent surgeon. This was the view pressed on Congressman Ron Wyden, Democrat of Oregon, by doctors in Oregon and by the AMA. He echoed these concerns in a speech on the House floor. Regardless of the guilt or innocence of the Astoria doctor, cases like this demonstrate that if this country wants physicians to come forward and prevent truly bad doctors from hurting people, there must be legal protection for them from the possibility of multi-million dollar litigation, years in court, and financial ruin. But while momentum to protect whistleblowing doctors gained force, the actual facts of the Patrick case were ignored. As Wyden's comment, regardless of the guilt or innocence of the Astoria doctor, makes obvious. A jury, the Ninth Circuit U.S. Court of Appeals, and the U.S. Supreme Court all eventually found that Dr. Patrick was competent, had not behaved negligently or recklessly, and was actually being hounded out of business by rival doctors' vindictive use of the peer review process. The doctors had begun their campaign against Dr. Patrick only after he rejected their offer of a partnership in the Astoria Clinic and set up a rival practice. The principal basis for the charge of incompetence and the attempted revocation of his hospital privileges was that Dr. Patrick had left a patient in the care of one of his colleagues. Even then, Patrick himself was only 90 minutes away, but no one had called him. The Court of Appeals noted that there was a great deal of testimony that Patrick was quite a good surgeon. If anything, the Patrick case seems a glaring example of how doctors can manipulate and abuse the peer review process to further their own economic interests and prevent competition. It should have been grounds for questioning peer review. As the Court of Appeals noted, there was substantial evidence that the defendants acted in bad faith in the hospital's peer review process. Yet the case instead became a national symbol for the persecution of doctors trying to use peer review to root out incompetence. The case was cited by Congressman Wyden when he introduced legislation on March 12, 1986, to immunize physicians engaged in peer review. The AMA has for years been trying to exclude the medical profession from antitrust liability, a move which, among other things, would free doctors from the laws banning price fixing and restraint of trade, and would all but certainly drive up the cost of medical care. The Wyden bill, cloaked in a concern for protecting the peer review process, was a significant step in that direction, and was quickly recognized as a Trojan horse by others in government. The proposed legislation attracted fierce opposition from the Federal Trade Commission, the Justice Department, the House and Senate Judiciary Committees, and the House Subcommittee overseeing the FTC, all bodies involved with overseeing the nation's antitrust laws, which saw it as a gambit to escape antitrust restrictions. Wyden's bill would have died quickly without the support of California Representative Henry Waxman, a powerful Democrat who was chairman of the House Subcommittee on Health and the Environment. It so happened that Dr. Brody, who had been highlighted on Nightline, had surfaced in California, Waxman's state. Wyden had added to his proposed law a provision that required doctors, in exchange for immunity, to report to a national clearinghouse actions taken against incompetent doctors. Hospitals would be required to check with the clearinghouse before they hired or extended hospital privileges to a physician. The Brody reporting provision, establishing a national data bank, cost Wyden the support of the AMA. Testifying in a hearing on the bill, a member of the AMA's Board of Trustees, Dr. Raymond Scaletter, complained that the national clearinghouse would be duplicative and unnecessary. There is no need to create a new body and source of data. Such data will include an extremely large amount of complex and possibly misleading information. But Wyden defended his approach of addressing the problem of rogue physicians in the same legislation that granted physicians immunity from the kind of liability faced by every other profession. "Well, I tell you, I think it is in the public interest to tie the two together," he said. "If we don't tie the two together, it seems to me that we are setting up a situation where rights are being given in particular to physicians and to medical providers. I am very much in favor of doing this. It is something I have put in many, many hours behind. I am in favor of those rights. But I am not in favor of giving those rights without some responsibilities which are in the public interest." With vigorous lobbying from the medical profession, however, crucial elements of the National Data Bank on Incompetent Physicians were watered down. The penalty for failing to comply was minimal. Nothing more than a presumption in any medical malpractice action against a hospital that the hospital had knowledge of any information available through the data bank. But the AMA still opposed the bill, largely because of the National Data Bank. In essence, the final bill provided that persons engaged in peer review activities could not be held liable for damages under any federal or state law as long as they complied with the act. In return, the proposed bill required state medical boards to report to a national data bank each time a physician's license was suspended for incompetence or misconduct. All health care entities were required to report actions adversely affecting the clinical privileges of a physician, as well as any instance in which they accepted a surrender of clinical privileges while a physician was under investigation. Thus, had the law been in effect in 1986 or made retroactive, the Ohio and Illinois state medical boards would have been required to report the suspension of Swango's medical license to the National Data Bank. The combined opposition of the AMA and virtually every governmental organization involved in antitrust enforcement seemed certain to doom the measure. But at the last minute, just 4 days before the 99th Congress was due to adjourn, Waxman displayed the legislative dexterity for which he is renowned. By tacking the bill onto an omnibus piece of health care legislation that already contained 8 other bills, he ensured that it would undergo minimal scrutiny. The bill, titled the Health Care Quality Improvement Act of 1986, was passed by the House of Representatives on October 17th. It was sponsored in the Senate, which held no hearings at all on the immunity or reporting measures, by then-Senator Al Gore, and was passed unanimously on October 18th. When President Reagan voiced misgivings and indicated that he might not sign the legislation, Representative Wyden took his case to the public in an opinion piece in the Washington Post. Although the establishment of a national data bank to keep tabs on incompetent doctors made up only a small part of the legislation, and although it had been watered down because of the opposition from the AMA, it was this provision that Wyden stressed. After reviewing the Brody case, he wrote, "There are many other cases like this one. The House Energy and Commerce Health and Environment Subcommittee heard testimony indicating that 3-5% of the doctors in this country account for most of the malpractice. There are 450,000 physicians nationwide. In other words, a moderate estimate indicates there may be 18,000 doctors regularly malpracticing. The need for legislation is clear. There is no effective national system for keeping tabs on doctors who are truly incompetent. Physicians have told the health subcommittee, on which I sit, that they are now afraid to speak out when a colleague malpractices. Hospitals can't take action against physicians they know are incompetent because they fear the legal consequences. The result? The incompetent doctor continues to practice, inflicting poor care and soaring costs on the unsuspecting." President Reagan signed the bill into law on November 14, 1986. The National Practitioner Data Bank was inaugurated in September 1990. Although the AMA had rather audaciously proposed that it be in charge of the data bank, It remains under the supervision of the Department of Health and Human Services, administered by a private company in Virginia. During the summer of 1991, while he was still living in the Newport News area, Michael Swango enrolled in an advanced life support course at Riverside Hospital. One day when he drove into the parking lot in his 1987 red pickup truck, he noticed an attractive young woman getting out of another red truck. He pointed out the similarity of their vehicles and introduced himself, using his real name. She said her name was Kristen Kinney. She was 25 years old, with beautiful, long, reddish-blonde hair. Kinney worked as a nurse in the intensive care unit at Riverside. She had recently returned from a stint as a traveling nurse in Naples, Florida, where she had made some close friends and enjoyed the work. But she returned to Virginia because she was dating Dr. Jerome Provenzano, a medical resident there. Swango told her he was a chemist. The two spoke occasionally during the course, but otherwise had little contact. Kristen was soon engaged to Dr. Provenzano, and she wasn't interested in dating Swango. Still, when the course ended and students filled out evaluations that asked for the best thing about this course, Swango responded, "Kristen Kinney." Kristen had been living with her mother and stepfather, Sharon and Al Cooper, but moved into her own apartment that summer. Sharon was an emergency room nurse, and Kristen had followed in her footsteps. Using fake names to preserve confidentiality, the two often traded stories about their patients. Once, Kristen told her mother about a patient who had tried to commit suicide by shooting himself in the head. He hadn't died, but would remain dysfunctional for life. The emergency room doctor had complained vociferously, Kristen reported. "If you want to commit suicide, shoot yourself in the chest," the doctor had proclaimed with exasperation. "Don't shoot yourself in the head." Kristen had a lively and at times wicked sense of humor. Because of it and her reddish hair, her mother and friends sometimes compared her to comedienne Lucille Ball. She was especially irreverent toward doctors. Once she was giving mouth-to-mouth resuscitation to an emergency room patient while a group of medical residents stood by. After struggling to stabilize the patient, she turned to them and asked, "Does anyone here want to play doctor?" Though Kristen initially resented her mother's new husband, Al, a retired Navy pilot, she called him Alpo after the dog food, she and her stepfather had developed a close rapport. She confided in him about her relationship with Provenzano, saying she was having doubts about the engagement. Provenzano would come home from his long stint at the hospital too tired to pay much attention to Kristen. She complained that he'd turn on the stereo and ignore her. She wasn't sure she wanted to marry a doctor. They seemed too consumed with their work to have much time left for family. Then one evening, Kristen called her parents to report that she'd met someone else, someone who promised, "He'll give me all his attention and take good care of me," as she told the Coopers. The young man she'd met in life support class, Michael Swango, now formally divorced from Rita, had been calling her, asking her to at least meet him for a cup of coffee. She'd finally agreed, even though one of her best friends, a nurse at Riverside, warned her to stay away from him. He'd applied to work at the hospital, but had been rejected because of something in his past. But the friend wasn't any more specific, and Kristen, who could be stubborn at times, preferred to trust her own judgment. She met Swango for coffee. She learned he was a Star Trek fan and loved Tom Clancy novels. He was soon calling her every night, showering her with attention and begging her to call off her engagement to Provenzano. "Now," Kristen told her parents, "I have a big decision to make." "Why don't you get away for a while?" Al Cooper suggested. So Kristen checked into a Holiday Inn on the ocean in Virginia Beach to think things over. The next day, Al called her there. "Have you made up your mind?" he asked her. "Yeah," she said. She paused, then added, "Michael showed up." Swango had tracked her down there and persuaded her to break the engagement. She told her stepfather she cared deeply for him and that he was a wonderful person. She assured him that Michael had a good job as a chemist. The Coopers were initially wary. Kristen, for all her vivacity and natural beauty, had not had good luck with men. She'd married a classmate from nursing school during her senior year, and he turned out to be a handsome rogue, cheating on her with other women. They were divorced 2 years later. Then she began dating someone who became so possessive that after she broke off the relationship, she had to obtain a court order preventing him from seeing her. She was so afraid of him that she bought a 9mm pistol and took target practice at a shooting range. She became a good shot and kept the gun in her truck, even after she moved back to Virginia from her stint in Naples. Not long after Kristen broke off her engagement, the Coopers let themselves into her apartment, as they often did, and were waiting for her to return when the phone rang. Sharon answered and told the caller she was Kristen's mother. "I love your daughter," Swango exclaimed. "I'll be good to her." Sharon couldn't get him off the phone, even though Al was growing annoyed. Swango went on and on about how wonderful Kristen was and how much he loved her. Sharon tried to ask him a few questions, but didn't make much headway. She couldn't deflect him from singing Kristen's praises. When Sharon finally got off the phone, she told her husband, "This is either the most wonderful thing in the world for Kristen, or he's some kind of nut." But Swango seemed so sincere, she couldn't really believe he might be the latter. A few weeks later, Kristen called her parents with a revelation about Swango. "Guess what?" she said. "The one thing I didn't want to have happen. Michael is actually a doctor." Al was startled. Hadn't Michael told her he was a chemist? "So he lied to you?" Al asked. "He didn't want to scare me away," Kristen explained. "What are you going to do now?" "I guess it's too late, isn't it?" she asked. Dr. Anthony Salem, director of the Internal Medicine Residency Program at the University of South Dakota in Sioux Falls, was sifting through completed applications in September 1991 when one letter captured his attention. "My situation is somewhat unusual," the letter read. "My medical career was interrupted by a personal tragedy in 1985. Under circumstances unrelated to medicine or medical practice, I was convicted of battery in the state of Illinois. I appealed the conviction vigorously, but without initial success in the courts. Upon completion of my probation, I began to rebuild my personal life and my medical career. In August 1989, I received a restoration of rights, removal of political disabilities from the governor of Virginia, Gerald Baliles. This is essentially a pardon for the conviction in Illinois and restores any and all rights." The letter was signed Michael Swango, not Adams. Intrigued, Dr. Salem looked through Swango's completed application. His credentials looked excellent. Salem was especially impressed by his internship at Ohio State, accompanied by the 1984 certificate signed by Sigourney and Carey. Unlike Ohio State or Iowa, the University of South Dakota Medical School did not enjoy a prestigious national reputation, though it was highly regarded in the northern plain states. Given the remote location and harsh weather, it wasn't easy to attract and retain competent doctors in the Dakotas, and USD tried to accept and train residents who showed some promise of remaining in the state. Increasingly, that had meant recruiting foreigners. So Swango's application was highly attractive, except for the curious matter of the battery conviction. Salem wondered what had happened. He was almost certain that a felony conviction would bar Swango from being admitted to the program, but he thought he'd follow up, mostly to satisfy his own curiosity. He suspected that Swango might have been convicted of some kind of domestic violence. Dr. Salem was known as thorough and meticulous, detail-oriented almost to a fault. On September 18th, he called the Illinois Department of Registration and Education, the Ohio State Medical Board, and the American Medical Association. Illinois reported that Swango's medical license had been revoked for disciplinary reasons. Ohio reported the same information. Neither licensing agency provided any details, saying only that Swango had been convicted of a felony. The AMA was even vaguer, responding over a month later that Swango had been subject to unspecified action by two licensing boards. All of this was consistent with what Swango had already revealed in his letter, and did nothing to signal any more serious problems. It also failed to satisfy Salem's curiosity. The next day, Salem had an associate contact Swango in Virginia, asking for more information about the battery conviction. And Swango provided a one-page supplement to his earlier letter and application. This time he abandoned the fictions he had created when he applied to the Wheeling, West Virginia residency program, fictions that had ultimately backfired. Not only was he using his real name, but he acknowledged that the battery was a case of poisoning, not a restaurant brawl. He explained that during the summer of 1985, he and his fellow paramedics had become suddenly ill at work. Swango himself, of course, had not been ill. To his utter surprise, several weeks later he was arrested and charged with putting something in their food and drink. He claimed the accusations were made by his co-workers, who were jealous of the fact that he was a physician. And he added that the physical evidence of poison had come from a state laboratory later closed by the governor of Illinois and the state police due to gross incompetence and numerous deficiencies. He offered to provide further information if requested. Now Salem was even more intrigued, and instead of rejecting the application outright, he called Swango on the phone. Swango was at his most charming and persuasive. He eagerly elaborated on the letter, weaving a sophisticated fabric of truth, half-truth, and outright fabrication to support his claim that he was a victim of a gross miscarriage of justice. Swango shrewdly premised his story on the notion of jealousy and hostility toward doctors, a scenario likely to appeal to other physicians who increasingly saw themselves confronted by hostile forces. Salem came away from this and several subsequent phone conversations persuaded that Swango was not only a remarkably candid young man, but also a courageous one. Increasingly, Salem found himself liking him. Still, he thought it unlikely that Swango could be a serious candidate, because USD policy was not to hire residents who couldn't later be licensed to practice medicine in South Dakota. Salem assumed that a felony conviction would preclude licensing. Hearing this, Swango himself offered to research the question and reported back to Salem that nothing in South Dakota law precluded him from being licensed if he showed he had successfully completed a 3-year residency. Without consulting anyone else in South Dakota, such as, for example, the university's lawyers, Salem accepted Swango's assertion and invited him to Sioux Falls for a round of personal interviews. While Swango's assertion may have been technically accurate, no law specifically bars a felon from practicing medicine. As a matter of policy, South Dakota treats felony convictions as a bar to licensure on the grounds that the underlying crime constitutes unprofessional conduct. 5 internists, including Salem, interviewed Swango on October 3rd. They asked him about his experience and knowledge of internal medicine and his willingness to practice in South Dakota. Dr. Salem asked him again whether he could be licensed to practice in the state. Swango emphasized that South Dakota was one of a handful of states where, if someone turns their life around, they can be licensed to practice. Incredibly, no one asked any other questions about his conviction on battery charges. Swango was seemingly earnest, sincere, persuasive. Salem's positive impressions were substantially reinforced by the meeting. It never occurred to Salem or anyone else who interviewed Swango to contact police or judicial authorities in Quincy. But the next day, when Swango was being interviewed by participants in the family practice program, to which he had also applied, things didn't go so smoothly. Dr. Bruce Vogt, the residency program coordinator at an area hospital, asked about the battery charges and seemed more skeptical of Swango's explanation. When he asked for Swango's permission to interview his parole officer, Swango seemed uncomfortable and finally refused. The group told Swango on the spot that they wouldn't consider his application any further. After the meeting, Swango lobbied Dr. Vogt, asking if there was any way he could apply for a transitional residency program directed by Vogt. Vogt told Swango it was possible, but he would probably be wasting his time. But no one who participated in the family practice interviews conveyed the group's decision or misgivings to Salem or anyone else in internal medicine. This wasn't so surprising, because the 2 residency programs often competed for the same applicants and tended to keep decisions to themselves. Then Salem learned from the Federation of State Medical Boards that Swango had had his licenses revoked by Illinois and Ohio, which Salem already knew, that his application for a license had been rejected by Virginia, and that he had legally changed his name to David Jackson Adams. The name change troubled Salem, but Swango explained on the phone and in writing that he had changed his name to Get a Fresh Start and had since reverted to using his real name. Perhaps most importantly, he wrote, I realized that I did not want there to be even the appearance of any attempt to conceal my past difficulties. To gain a residency appointment in South Dakota, Swango had to go through the same national match process that had gotten him accepted by Iowa and then Ohio State. The University of South Dakota's Internal Medicine Residency Ranking Committee met on February 24, 1992, to rank the 17 applicants still under consideration for the 8 positions in the program. 4 doctors attended, including Dr. Salem and Dr. Vogt, who had participated in the family practice discussions. For the first time, Dr. Vogt told the group that the family practice group had declined to rank Swango. But Dr. Salem argued persuasively on Swango's behalf. Since Salem had had by far the most contact with him, and the other doctors trusted Salem's judgment, they decided to rank Swango. However, there was little expectation that he would rank high enough to gain a match and hence an appointment. Dr. Vogt ranked Swango last or close to last. So did one of the other doctors. Another ranked him only several names from the bottom. But Dr. Salem must have given him a fairly high ranking, because when the results were totaled, Swango ranked 11th of the 17 candidates. Of the 6 applicants ranked behind him, 5 were foreign doctors. The other showed evidence of mental instability. The results of the national match program were announced on March 18, 1992. Swango was accepted to a residency in internal medicine at the University of South Dakota. Now that Swango's future seemed secure, he and Kristen became engaged in May 1992. He took her shopping for a ring, and she chose a small diamond in an antique shop. Kristen loved old jewelry and antiques. The Coopers finally met Swango that same month at a dinner at Gus's Mariner restaurant located on the beach. Swango was neatly dressed, poised, and charming. Sharon thought he treated her daughter like a queen. He held her hand throughout the meal and told the Coopers how much he loved her. Kristen beamed with appreciation, and her parents thought she'd never looked better. She showed them her new ring and said she'd be moving to South Dakota with Maiko, as she called him. But they weren't planning to be married right away. During dinner, Al asked Swango to tell him about his background in education. He mentioned his many awards and achievements, his medical degree, his internship at Ohio State. But Al noticed there was a gap of about 3 years from 1984 to 1987, and he asked Swango what he was doing then. "I'll tell you about that later," Swango said mysteriously, though he gave no hint it was anything awkward or embarrassing. "It's not important." He said nothing about any previous marriage. The Coopers also asked about Swango's parents. He told them about his father's military career and that he had died. He said nothing about his mother, so Al asked about her. Swango paused, then said, "She's in a nursing home." "Where?" the Coopers asked. "In Missouri," Swango replied. He seemed uncomfortable and volunteered nothing further. "When was the last time you saw her?" Al continued. Swango paused. "I haven't." Kristen jumped in to diffuse what was rapidly becoming a tense conversation. "It's really a sad story," she said. "He'll tell you about it sometime." In fact, after Muriel complained to Judge Cashman just after Michael's conviction that she wasn't feeling well, her physical and mental health had deteriorated rapidly. She had confided in Ruth Miller that having 2 sons reject her when she refused to fund the appeal was even worse than Mike's arrest and conviction. Still, she never broke down or showed any self-pity, preferring to keep her feelings to herself. After the trial, Muriel had moved back to Florida to be near her youngest son, John. But a thank-you note to Louise Scharf in Springfield not long after Michael's sentencing had been oddly written and barely coherent. Muriel soon entered a nursing home in Palmyra, Missouri, not far from Quincy. She was diagnosed as suffering from Alzheimer's disease. But family members were convinced she was suffering from a broken heart, as Scharf put it. She never got over the fact that Mike was found guilty, and then Mike and Dick turned their backs on her. She might have made it through the loss of 1 son, but not 2. The Coopers, of course, knew none of this. After their dinner, Kristen walked with them to their car and asked them what they thought of Mike. It was obvious she wanted their approval, and they gave it. Al said,
If you can deal with the gap in his resume, then I think you've got a winner. But both Coopers were more troubled than they let on. And more by the fact that Swango had never visited his ailing mother than by the mysteries in his background. As they reached their car, Al said to Sharon, I hope he is what he says he is.
The Context of White Supremacy, Katherine Massey, Book Club. Master Deceiver. Why didn't they just be honest and say that? Like, I don't know. First time we met this guy, like, I don't know. Seems kind of, be honest, I guess. Be honest. Don't be lying. Gee whiz. We'll pick up there in Chapter 7 for next Thursday. Number to dial, 605-313-5164. The code, 564-943, pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Email untiljustice@gmail.com. Let's see. Nab the rest of our emails, and then we'll get our callers, get my notes in, be done for session number 5. Let's see. Dr. Peer review the evaluation of practicing physicians by other physicians. The National Practitioner Data Bank was inaugurated in September 1990. It remains under the supervision of the Department of Health and Human Services. I have witnessed the so-called peer review process weaponized against black physicians through suspending hospital privileges based on flimsy charges. It is my understanding that there is not much independent scrutiny outside the institution, and trying to get it reversed through the legal system is expensive, nearly impossible. Moreover, it is reported to the NPDB and remains on your record forever, which can be devastating when trying to obtain employment at another institution unless you are a smooth, good-looking, blue-eyed white person. About the NPDB, one, if a malpractice suit is filed and no monetary damages are awarded, then nothing is reported to the NPDB. Two, things which are reported, medical malpractice awards, federal and state licensure awards, adverse clinical privileges, adverse professional society membership actions, negative actions or findings by the private accreditation or peer review organizations, healthcare-related criminal convictions and civil judgments, exclusions from participation in federal or state healthcare programs, Medicare, Medicaid, other adjudicated actions or decisions, the data from the NPDB is not available to the public. Moreover, due to physician shortages, many physicians are being hired from foreign countries, and I suspect it is hard to obtain information regarding any adverse actions which took place in foreign countries, as physicians have transitioned from independent private practice positions to employer-employee positions with large healthcare corporations. It has become much easier to de facto fire physicians because provisions are written into contracts such that they can be let go without cause, with often with only 90-day notice, meaning goodbye, and the organization is not obligated to say why, which they can use to their benefit for a situation like Swango, where they don't have to give out any of the details about what was this white person doing. 4. Kristen, she was 25 years old with beautiful, long, reddish, blonde hair. None of that Brazilian crespo, kinky hair. Absolutely, we never hear about a white person who has bad hair. Never, 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 never. There is never a white person, oh my God, these kinks. And, oh, I can't believe I got this mat of fur on top. Never, 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 never. 5. Dr. Anthony Salem phone conversations. Swango was not only a remarkably candid young man, but also a courageous one. Found himself liking him. Of the 6 applicants ranked behind him, 5 were foreign doctors. The others showed evidence of mental instability. Ohio State replied that both Swango and the University of South Dakota would have to execute waivers and hold harmless agreements. At no point in this process does it seem to have occurred to anyone at the National Practitioner Data Bank had anything on Swango. The operating system always seems to default towards positive feelings towards suspected racists, no matter the evidence to the contrary. So you rank someone else with mental instability. What does that mean? Were they also convicts? The way that letter was worded from OSU, execute waivers, and that's not a red flag question. None of the most rudimentary safeguards when evaluating applicants. If the process was this lax, what other incompetent doctors, not necessarily murdering psychopaths, were unleashed on the public? Dr. Kaplan did say that this is a growing problem. Now, he was talking about killers specifically, but I mean, hey, a drunk during the surgery type of a thing. Abusing the medication and then they slip, you know, saline solution into your IV, that type of a thing. How we got in this opioid epidemic, that type of a thing. Same thing I said before, hey, if it was 00 Welsing, alrighty, I wish so badly I had known of this. This book was published in 99, man. Over 20 years. They probably got the 25-year anniversary edition. I wish I had known about that. I know. I've got the kind of Chicago connection there, too, because he was an Illinois medical doctor and all of this. I know Dr. Welsing knew about, and he ended up in Zimbabwe. Like, I know she would have known about this case. May have even read this book. Oh, I would have loved to have heard. Oh, tragic miss. Put that up with there with Henrietta Lacks. Anyway, number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. See if any of the folks listening in, if they have thoughts, the second portion of the audio. Let's see. Maybe they're spectating. Give folks a moment if they're spectating, get their thoughts together. Let me see. Get my notes for the second portion of the reading. Okay. I'm glad that he gave additional details about the lawsuit from Oregon, where they say that they have this doctor who's incompetent and the other physicians are trying to take him to court to say that he shouldn't be allowed to practice. I was wondering, well, wait a minute, is that actually true? That's what I was thinking, like, is that true? Because it seemed to be like, you know, if he's trying to open up his own practice, is this, you know, like, hey, you can't be competing with us. We got our monopoly on patients. You can't be, you know, wrecking our business model here. We'll say he's incompetent. Yeah, yeah. And then he went into detail about that. Like, yeah, nobody actually checked the Patrick verdict. It seems like this guy actually was credible. And they were trying to bully him so that he couldn't wreck their monopoly on all of the patients, and it in fact seemed like another example of white doctors taking advantage of the peer review system and using it to their advantage financially or for whatever. They just are being vindictive. I thought that was really important to go into detail about that as well. And this is being used as justification that we doctors, we are being picked on. You're leveling all these suits against us, and you're not even interested in getting rid of incompetent doctors. Like, get out of here. Let's see. The AMA for years has been trying to exclude the medical profession from antitrust liability, a move which, among other things, would free doctors from the laws banning price fixing and restraint of trade and would all but certainly drive up the cost of medical care. The Wyden bill, cloaked in a concern for protecting the peer review process, was a significant step in that direction and was quickly recognized as a Trojan horse by others in government. Man, particularly, we just talked about the lack of pharmacies, right? Like 3 days ago on this program, particularly for black people. And within that, black people are charged more for the very same medication. All of that deliberate, willful, and they've been trying to even make this worse. Get a total monopoly so we're not subject to any. We can charge as much as we want for Ozempic, insulin, Wegovy, any of these other medications after we've drugged you and filled you up with high fructose corn syrup and all the rest of it. Now we can charge you, you know, astronomical amounts, you know, pay off all of our medical debt. Then we can go out yachting. Let's see. They get immunity for doctors, so there's no way that we can, you know, get in trouble if we are reporting to the data bank and that sort of thing. Like, so much protection for these are already like very powerful figures, and we can lobby and change laws so that we get even more protections to safeguard us and protect us when we engage in malpractice. Let's see. They can go use the press to lobby for why we do not need all of this oversight and doubling up on surveillance of white healthcare practitioners, that we already have a shortage of doctors and we don't want all this strain and pressure on doctors. And they have all the power to lobby white lawmakers. I don't think if it was a lot of black, if it was lots of Dr. Welsings, I don't think they would have the same clout to go and lobby their friends in Congress, Ronald Reagan, and you need to veto this one. Don't get behind this one. Let's see. There's lots more information. Kristen Kinney and what happened to she and the folks in Virginia. There's a lot more information that was published after this book came out. If you want to check the local paper in the Newport News, Virginia area, they go into detail about she and all that. The Swang, amazing. This is what happens when you are not in a system of justice. All of this lying and mistreatment, hey, passing things on down the road, well, this is what happens. Let's see. Kristen Kinney, the white woman who Swango is all interested in now briefly, she has a fiancé during all of this. She says he would come home from his long stints at the hospital too tired to pay much attention to her. She complained that he'd turn on the stereo and ignore her. She wasn't sure she wanted to marry a doctor. They seemed too consumed with their work to have much time left for family. Just, we've heard this before. Heard this with Swango. Heard this with Lionel Dahmer, Jeffrey Dahmer's father. Heard this with Chris Kyle, American Sniper. He wasn't a doctor. Neither was Dahmer's dad. Not even that interested in this whole family thing, children thing. Some folks even said that about Tom Klebold and Sue Klebold. We'll get deal later. We got art projects to work on. White people don't care about children. Kristen, apparently one of her friends, a nurse at Riverside, warned her to stay away from Swango. He'd applied to the work at the hospital but had been rejected because of something in his past, all that vagueness. Now that happens too. You hear that often where it'll be a family member or a friend will tell you, like, I don't know, girl, maybe leave this one alone. Like, and you ignore, trust my judge. Michael is cool. I know. I love Michael's all right, man. He calls me and everything. That's a good looking blue eyed white. Okay. Ask lots of questions, man. Even that vagueness, something is like, what is that? That's why Mr. Fuller says so much. I didn't know. Felony battery for poor. Woo. I didn't know. Like, yes, ask lots of questions. They go meet Kristen's parents, go do, or she starts about breaking off the engagement and all of that. She tells her stepdad that she finds out he's a doctor. And he says, so he lied to you. He says, well, you just, you know, you didn't want to scare me away. It's just too late now. No, it is not too late. And even when he said, so he lied to you, like, that is so huge. The foundation of this arrangement, how we're starting out, is a lie. I would say for anybody, like, man, you know, doing any sort of male, female, trying to find this care mate type of a thing, and lies at the beginning. Whoa. Particularly any sort of big lie. Like, that's why Fuller says, like, this is personal to you. You know what's important to you. So you've already done this. You know, I don't want to be involved with a doctor. You know, that's really time consuming. And I like to cuddle and everything, take weekend trips. And they're not interested in all that. They work all day and want to come home and crash, snort some cocaine. Who knows? They don't want to cuddle. I don't want to do that. Starts off with a lie, something that's important. He didn't tell you he's a doctor. Especially if he did you ask? He says, or even if he didn't, if he says, I'm this, and it turns out that he's a doctor, like, oh, man. Man, oh, man. Major at red flag, halt, stop. Is there anything else that you've lied to me about, deceived me about? Anything else that I'm going to down there, like, oh, man, that is a big one. Why didn't you tell me that? I wish I had known that. Let's see. All of this at South Dakota One, the school paper at the University of South Dakota, they have a lot of articles on Michael Swango. If we have any folks there, I would love to check out some of what they said. The South Dakota local papers, I think it's the Argus Leader, that paper also has quite a bit on Michael Swango in this case and how he got admitted to the school and everything. Given the remote location and harsh weather, it wasn't easy to attract and retain competent doctors in the Dakotas, and the USD tried to accept and train residents who showed some promise of remaining in the state. Increasingly, that meant recruiting foreign doctors. I swear, I think that means non-white people. So Swango's application was highly attractive. That's why, because I don't think it's that, you know, this is such a smart dude, or he's so, you know, just amazing recommendations and such. It's that this is a blue-eyed, smooth, good-looking white man. You don't have to get one of these old, dark, funny-talking non-white people come over here. I could be in error. Let's see. Again, if this had been 00 Welsing and she puts her application in, and Dr. Salem knows that they, you know, hey, we do not accept felons, that would have, oh, look at this, oh, cute Negro apply. Oh, and a felony Negro too. Trash. And that would have been that. But blue-eyed, smooth-talking, good-looking, blonde-haired white man. Give him another. What is it? Want to be fair. Let's see. Illinois reported that Swango's medical license had been revoked for disciplinary reasons. Ohio reported the same information. Neither licensing agency provided any details, saying only that Swango had been convicted of a felony. The AMA was even vaguer, responding over a month later that Swango had been subject to unspecified action by two licensing boards. All of that vagueness, that's something I talk about all the time, like being vague with land, particularly. This is someone who was convicted of poisoning white medics. None of that. You got transcripts and everything. None of that is passing. It's a little shady. Frank, what do you mean? A little shady. Disciplinary reasons. I mean, what... He overslept? Like, what does that mean? What does that mean? He told some racist jokes? What does that mean? He tried to kill five people? Like, come on. And if they had more doctors, health workers who were non-white, I don't think it would be a practice of being that vague and nondescript. I could be totally in error. Swango, master deceiver, Micah. So he starts his lie here. He says, hey, man, so I got this felony conviction. It was for poisoning. We had the spicy chicken. I got sick. Paul got the... Everybody got sick. They come and say that I poisoned. Like, what? Now, come on. Playing the victim. That seems to be so standard system of white supremacy. I was a victim. I was coughing my lungs out, too. Swango was at his most charming and persuasive. He eagerly elaborated on the lever, weaving a sophisticated fabric of truth, half-truth, and outright fabrication to support his claim that he was a victim of a gross miscarriage of justice. Swango shrewdly premised his story on the notion of jealousy and hostility towards doctors, a scenario likely to appeal to other physicians who increasingly saw themselves as confronted by hostile forces. Are you serious? To me, that sounds like just psychopaths. I can empathize with other psychopaths. Say, game, recognize game, my sick white brother. They're just beating up on me. I'm just an old beaten up white man. You can empathize, can't you? Say, yeah, they beating up on me too. Yeah, yeah, trying to subject us to all these sanctions. Yeah, say we got a report to the database. Yeah, they're just always beating up on us white people, aren't they? Yeah, my white brother. Of course we're going to give you a chance. I got your back, my sick white brother. That's what it sounds like to me, man. That white victimization is so extraordinary. It knows no geographical limits. It spans all time. It never goes out of style. I am a victim. Even a victim of racism. That's coming up in the backlog. This book just gets better as we go. I cannot believe it. Salem came away from this and several subsequent phone conversations persuaded that Swango was not only a remarkably candid, I think that means something close to honest, doesn't it? Whew. Candid young man, but also a courageous one. What is courageous about 00 Swango? Please tell me. They don't even investigate. Like, I could see if it was like you were going to do all of this and you know they are going to double check everything. They're calling Virginia. They're calling Illinois. Quincy, they're going to talk to my probation on all of that. Maybe, but I mean, they don't even check. They don't even look. What's courageous about what? Let's see. Swango himself offered to research the question and reported back to Dr. Salem that nothing in South Dakota law precluded him from being licensed if he showed he had successfully completed a 3-year residency without consulting anyone else in South Dakota, such as, for example, the university's lawyers. Salem accepted Swango's assertion and invited him to Sioux Falls for a round of personal interviews. For that to be so common. That's not turning a blind eye, in my opinion. That's not even looking the other way. That is willful. Total deliberate disregarding of rules, regulation, protocol. He said, I know we don't even take felons, but this, I like the cut of his jib. This blue-eyed white man is just, I don't know, Michael just, that's a courageous white man. Let's give him a chance. Like, come on. That's not looking the other way, man. That's not blind eye. No. And dare I say, none of this would have happened if it was 00 Welsing. Deliberate practice of white supremacy. Some of this, it could just be, man, what's my term for workplace racism? Cronyism. Isn't this cronyism? I'm saying it's cronyism because he wouldn't have said, I found myself liking this dude. If it was Leroy, old raping non-Clemson dad, Ben Carson, Gus T, he wouldn't have, I like this Gus fella. I like his spunk. I like his moxie. Yeah. We're going to get, no. Because this is a white dude, let's give him a chance. And then you take his, that too is so, if it was Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, they would not have taken Dr. Welsing's word. Oh, wow. This nigga woman, in addition to knowing biology, chemistry, she is a student of jurisprudence and South Dakota law. Wow. How amazing. What a nigga woman. We got to get her in the No. You don't even check with anybody else. Let me make sure. Is it possible that we could take a felon into our residency program? Do we make an exception
He's got really blue eyes. You got to see him. He got amazing blue eyes. You got to see. I just don't think they would have done that for Leroy, Jamal, me. Maybe I'm wrong. No one asks any questions about the, like, all of this lack of attention to detail, man. I can't bring up enough, man. When I go to the bank, not $1 million, not $10,000, not $5,000. They ask me way more questions. There is way more scrutiny. What are you doing with this? Who are you? Where did you get this from? Let me get a urine sample, fingernail sample. Where's your birth certificate? All these questions. Scrutiny, you do not get the benefit of the day. It's assumed. You might be Osama bin Laden cousin. Related to a rental chain. You raped any white women? Told you, non-Clemson dad, you raped any white women today? That's never that. You got a felon right here. Maybe he's a rapist. We don't know. We don't. That's a good looking white. You know he didn't rape anybody. Shut up saying that. I say, he goes through the match program again. Apparently, Mr. Stewart, James B., the author, he gets enough information for us to find out that Swango ends up ranked somewhere in the middle. They say that Dr. Salem must have given him a fairly high ranking because when the results were tallied, Swango ranked 11th of the 17 candidates. Of the 6 applicants ranked behind him, 5 were foreign doctors. I had a full stop right there. Do we think foreign in this instance might be a synonym for not white? I will take that bet all day, every day, that in fact that all of them, not 2 or 3, all of them, not white, which is staggering because it could be all of those foreigners, they could all be Lucy Letby's cousins. They could be killers too. I think our caller wrote that in, or listener wrote that in. That it's hard to vet doctors in general, and the foreign health workers in particular is so far away. Maybe they have standardized process for keeping records and all of that. Maybe they don't. How do you get access to it? Maybe you do. Maybe you don't. But dang, all of them were worse than Michael Swango. Michael Swango wasn't even competent. That was a part of it at Ohio State, too. It wasn't like they were saying that, man, this guy is good looking and blue-eyed and works hard and everything. And competent, top of his class. Dang, if we could just get him to stop poisoning people. That's not what they said. They said he wasn't even competent. He didn't even, where, what is this in the chest? You remember that? What is this in the chest area, Swango? They got to tell him, it's the heart, fool. Come on, I don't even believe. I think that's another one. Total cronyism. I don't think Dr. Salem would have ranked this dude this high and been so impressed with him if he had been classified as not white. Felon, come on. Let's see. I don't know who this Al is, Kristen's stepdad, but man, his attention to detail where they're having dinner with old Michael and Kristen, and he's listening to his background and what he does and everything. He says, what's up with that gap there, that 2-year gap there? What were you doing during that time? Brilliant, brilliant. Just paying attention to the details, man. Like, oh, you got a little period there. What were you doing then? You took some time off. What's going on? Oh, get to that another time. What? Write that down. Red flag, at least suspicious. Like, what were you doing then? You on safari in Africa? What were you doing then? Let's see. His mom, for she says, either she's got a winner or this guy's a real nut. That's another one. That reminded me, in fact, when we read Gavin DeBecker, The Gift of Fear, when you get those signals, either this guy is amazing or he is a total nut. We need to make sure that we have resolved that first one, or the second one, rather. Make sure we did not get the total nut. someone lies to you at the very beginning, particularly about things that are important to you, you know you don't want a doctor, and they lie about that. That includes omitting, leaving out really crucial details. Oh, man. They got gaps and things, questions that they don't answer. They give you real vague details. Red flag. Gift of fear, man. You have those suspicions for a reason. At least you want valid answers to your questions so your suspicion can be allayed. And then last thing I'll say, just parents, be honest with your children. You know, hey, friends, we already had that in the book where other people told her, leave this dude alone, and she ignored them. They do, this happens with parents as well. At least be honest. Don't worry about hurting their feelings, your children, your offspring. Don't worry about, you know, telling them what they want to hear and all of that. We could be talking about your child's life. They got big reports on Kristen Kinney in Virginia. Big report. I'm sure some of that is not here because it was published after this book came out. Be honest with your children. You see some red flags, something is questionable, and you think they just got emotionally caught up in this and what have you, and they're just, you know, not being out, or maybe they just haven't been able to see it truthfully for what's really happening here. Say something. Any hoodles? Let's see. Didn't miss anybody? Nobody? Final comments they want to make sure they get in? Grand. We will pick up next week. I have learned, so I think this book is so important. The racism aspect, that is going to become very flagrant as the book proceeds. But even this, I think it is so important. I would check. There are tons of these dudes. I had no idea. I had no idea. And we started this program talking about Dr. Byrne was a different suspected racist doctor. They were saying he was killing non-white people. Not exclusively. But, oh, man. Imminent danger. They got pictures of non-white people victims of racism. Like I said, that's maternal mortality right there. Right there. They don't even talk about that as a component of it, or iatrogenic deaths, as they are called. Just saying these are doctor mistakes and all the rest of it, either or. Incompetence, deliberate, all the same. Man, that is widespread. Be alert. Take someone with you if you have to go to the doctor, just so they can ask questions. If you know someone and they have any sort of medical expertise, see if you can email them, text them, do a Zoom, sit and have some coffee, whatever it is. Just ask questions so you can be more informed. You can go online and all of that. They have healthcare forms and all the rest of it as well. Just do your best to be informed. Speak to other people who are knowledgeable and make sure if you have to go, hospital, doctor, whatever it is, take someone with you. Hopefully, if you have someone with some medical expertise, great, even better. But just take someone with you. They are upright, alert, and can help ask questions, bear witness. So glad we're reading this book. So wish we had read this while Dr. Welsing was still with us in the physical form. I know she was aware of this book, though. Gary Ware, if you do not know Gary, even that. That is another reason right there. I saw his name. I haven't even read Dark Alliance, but I know what it's about. We almost read it in the book club right after the O.J. Simpson session. But that right there, like, wow, when you read nonfiction, you can learn a lot. I did not know Gary Webb started writing in Ohio about all kinds of things, including white physician malpractice Michael Swango, and then transitioned to, dang, California Highway Patrol is terrorizing black people. Dang, the CIA is peddling cocaine. All of that super important. That's why you read nonfiction. If anybody can get those ABC report, Nightline 2020, The Plain Dealer, Gary Webb, 7-part series, I would love to check that out as well. If you've not read Dark Alliance or don't know who Gary Webb is, reading is more important than watching television. Even if you do want to watch TV, Kill the Messenger, documentary about Gary Webb, right there. Wonder if Swango and all this will come up in it. We'll be here tomorrow for Neutralizing Workplace Racism. Same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. No name calling. sobriety would be best. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No throwaway offspring. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
No problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.